No, it's good. Thank you. puck is going to start first, or you're sitting down first. I told her that she's going to appreciate me taking 2 minutes because you guys are already behind schedule. I know, but this won't start for another 5. Then you're going to have speakers that are going to say they're going to take 10 minutes and they'll take 25.
I know. I keep trying to tell people because I thought it was a no-brainer, especially with iPhones coming out, but all you have to do is use a little timer on the iPhone. How hard is it?
Well, actually, when I was the one I love that we do at Krupsy now, we have a clock that we put right in front of the speaker. And it's incredible how effective it is.
We don't have to stay here. We don't have to stay here.
Oh, no, we're going to leave after we talk.
Well, I'm actually staying for the morning, but I can go so I don't have to stay here.
Oh, no, we're just here. She just wanted us here because she's going to do the intro.
All right.
Something like that. John Savage.
Thank you.
Did you speak at a neighbor's meeting a while ago? Yeah. Pretty close. Here's your cousin. And this morning I looked because I had made some changes.
Holy crap!
Well, no, I want to show every minute.
You're taking my time, too.
I'm wondering if we can get started.
Like
it's a little behind schedule already, but there's so many folks here.
Let's see.
Wait, do I need to be louder?
No, I realized, I should look and see what I printed out, because
louder.
I did the last 2 pages, and I found, I would have been repeating myself.
I'm tired. Hi, everyone. Could we try to get seated? I know it's an early start, but we've given you some coffee and snacks, and we're really hoping that you're coming in wide-eyed, bushy-tailed. Also, this is going to be a packed house. We were so fortunate to have a great response, so I really, if you could, instead of saving that seat between you and the next person, scoot in so that more people can sit down so we don't have standers in the back. So please help with that. I know we're going to pull in, maybe Alan, you could even wave. We could wave to the people in the hallway, get them to come in. Is it all right?
Much okay. Too nice. I think you should just shut the door.
Try
doors.
Now? Better? How's that? Better? Thank you. Thanks, Doug. Yeah. So I want to welcome you to the Oregon Energy Storage Workshop today. We have a long day, a full schedule. We're very excited about this. My name is Rebecca O'Neill. I work for the Oregon Department of Energy. I'm a policy analyst there. And I, along with my colleague Richie Sadier from the Oregon PUC, are going to be your MCs today. So you'll look for us for transitions in your agenda. First, I want to thank our sponsors. We have two terrific sponsors. One is the U.S. Department of Energy. They have been providing, of course, they've been providing technical assistance broadly for a long time for a lot of us. But for us in particular, they came in and they provided financial assistance and a lot of direct technical assistance to make this workshop happen. So we really appreciate the efforts of the U.S. Department of Energy and Sandia National Labs and Clean Energy States Alliance. I also want to thank the University of Oregon School of Law. Not only did they help us co-sponsor this beautiful space, but they provided a phalanx of law students that are here to help us today. You've seen them at the roundtables. These guys are going to be helping us from everything from running mics to taking notes at the roundtables this afternoon, and we're so fortunate to have them. Also, they're going to be your best legal minds on energy storage in a few years, so keep them in mind. Today, we've given you a folder that has an agenda in it. It also has a welcome letter from our agencies, trying to give you a sense of what this workshop is all about. We've provided you with biographies of our speakers, our panelists, and our roundtable hosts. We also provided you with a paper on grid energy storage to help give you a primer on the issues so that we don't have to cover those today, so we can start talking about projects and we can start talking about value streams. We also have overviews of all of the roundtables. So if you haven't yet decided what roundtable is okay for you, and a lot of people have asked me, take a look at the roundtable packets and start to read through and think about where you think you might provide the most value or you might learn the most. Either way, we're really interested in outcomes from the roundtables. So since we have such a tight timeline, I really want to get started. I want to introduce, we have executive leadership from both of our agencies here today. We have Lisa Schwartz, who's my director. I'm very pleased that she's able to make it. Lisa has a long history and tenure in renewable energy policy in the West, but has experience, of course, at both our agencies, the Oregon PUC and the Department of Energy, before taking over at the helm of the Department of Energy about a year ago now. And we also have John Savage, and of course I'm doing abbreviated versions, I hope everyone understands. He's been a commissioner of the Oregon PUC for over 10 years, and he's also previously served as the director of the Oregon Department of Energy. So, with that, I'd like to invite Lisa to come up and give us some opening remarks. Bring this back in.
Thanks, Rebecca. Good morning, everyone. It's great to see such a big crowd, and I'm happy to see so many of our partners here today at the local level, state level, national level. And again, thanks to our sponsors at the U.S. Department of Energy and University of Oregon School of Law for their support. My department's been monitoring energy storage for a long time now. Developments at the industry level, demonstration projects, and policy developments really in other states and at the federal level. But today we want to take the first step toward building a roadmap with all of our stakeholders to see what kind of cohesive vision we might have for our state regarding energy storage. A workshop we thought would help us build consensus around the most important applications for energy storage here. We'd explore questions like, should we focus on grid resiliency for critical service providers, like hospitals and fire stations? How can we use bulk energy storage to help build flexibility into the electric grid? A workshop could also help us target the most valuable investment strategies in this emerging sector. For example, what role should demonstration projects have at this stage at a larger scale? Should we use incentive programs to help influence the market here? And how do we help our utility partners take some of the emerging technologies from our universities and help us commercialize those, but at a rate that makes sense and is prudent for ratepayers? We also thought a workshop could help us figure out what utilities really need to confidently integrate energy storage in cost-effective and predictable ways. So we're looking to this workshop to give us fresh ideas and perspectives. We want to hear how the state can help advance the most important energy storage applications in the short run and in the long run. We've lined up really good speakers today to help us understand better the state of energy storage deployment throughout the region and to help advise us on how energy storage benefits really could be better valued and realized in a fair way. Still, I want to disclose I'm coming to the workshop with a few premises. First is simply, for me, energy storage is important for our future power system to meet statutory goals for reducing greenhouse gases. We need to find ways to effectively address the increased variability and uncertainty that wind and solar do bring to the power system. We need to reduce the cost of integrating these resources because we're going to need a lot more of them in the future. How much? Well, I asked my staff to do some basic math. Working backwards from the state's statutory goal for reducing greenhouse gases in the year 2050, which targets a 75% reduction in greenhouse gas emissions compared to the year 1990. The idea was really to solve for the lowest amount of renewable resources that we could put on our system to meet the goal. And what we found is something like 80% of our electricity mix must be carbon free. And that's assuming heroic numbers for our hydro system, given all the competing demands that we have on our hydro system today, and that's growing. Today, only about half of the electricity we consume in the state comes from non-carbon sources. So we have a long way to go. But to make efficient investments in renewable energy at higher levels of penetration, we'll need a stable of enabling technologies. Energy storage in all its varied forms is going to be a very important part of that stable of technologies. Okay, a second premise that I'm bringing with me today is that energy storage has important value for resiliency and reliability of our power system. Energy storage can protect against our greatest vulnerabilities when the power system and our critical services are most stressed. And in some cases, energy storage may be the most cost-effective thing we can do today, at the end of the line, for example, when we're looking to make upgrades to our transmission and distribution systems to reliably deliver power. And the third premise I'm bringing with me today is that there are unwarranted barriers to energy storage that we can eliminate through collective action. The state should help identify and remove barriers, and we want to get going on that work. We also would like to see if we can play a role for greater cooperation to deliver more demonstration projects. And we'd like to see more market opportunities overall. Energy storage technologies are really quickly developing. So what actions can we take today? What building blocks can we put in place to position the state for our long-term needs? And while state policies and regulatory actions will play an important role, it may be that simply retooling our thinking, our modeling and valuation, that would do the most to advance the sector as costs come down. So I look forward to hearing from you today, what our agency can do to help advance energy storage in Oregon, and I thank you for coming and sharing your perspectives. Commissioner Savage.
Commissioner Director. So I'm going to keep this short and sweet. First of all, I like the image of a phalanx of law students. Good morning. I chair our Western Energy Group that just sponsored a webinar on a study by E3 on the impacts of meeting higher RPS standards in California. If you haven't seen the study, get it. It's worth the read. But I was struck by one of the presentation slides at the webinar. And this slide shows generation by hour for a sample day in April, assuming a 33% RPS standard in California, a 40% RPS standard, and a 50% RPS standard. Now these charts are stacked on top of each other. So there's a 33% at the bottom, 40% in the middle, and 50% on top, all in one slide. Now from the period, and it shows 24 hours. Now for the period from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m., as you move from the 33% chart to the 40% chart to the 50% chart, this pimple forms, and it grows, and it grows. And the height of the pimple represents the amount of excess generation beyond demand in California, just California. At a 40% level, the amount of excess generation is roughly 10,000 megawatts. At a 50% RPS level, the amount of excess generation is more than 20,000 megawatts. So I'm looking at this slide, and two obvious thoughts pop in my head. Number one, California relatively soon may have to curtail a lot of renewable generation. And two, wouldn't it be good if we had cost-effective storage to help soak up this excess generation? So storage technologies, to me, have long held great potential and great promise as transformative technologies. But they have not realized their potential, and they won't, unless we do three things. One, we got to bring down costs. Two, we got to test them. And three, we got to get people comfortable incorporating them into our energy systems on a large scale. So with these as my ultimate aims, I'm looking forward to today's discussions and presentations. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Savage and Director Schwartz. Good morning, my name is Ruchi Sudhir. I'm with the Oregon Public Utility Commission. Before introducing our keynote speaker, I'd like to take a moment to share our goals for the workshop today and walk through the agenda. The overall goal of today's workshop is to help develop a path forward for Oregon to advance deployment of energy storage technologies. We hope that you will help workshop attendees reach a common understanding of energy storage landscape in Oregon today and assess its potential for development of energy storage technologies. In addition, we hope that you will identify barriers and possible solutions to development of energy storage projects while also identifying promising future energy storage projects and applications. As Rebecca mentioned earlier, in your welcome folder, you'll find a workshop agenda. Our day together starts with two expert panels. The first will discuss energy storage projects, and the second will discuss energy storage values. Each panel will begin with a short introduction by Rebecca or me. Then each panelist will provide a brief presentation, and finally each panel will end with questions from you all. Please think about your questions as you listen to the panelists' presentations, but hold those questions until the end. We plan to take a short break for you to refresh your coffees in between our expert panels, and before lunch at 12:30, we'll pause to give you instructions for the afternoon roundtables and a final chance to sign up for one. Please use the roundtable background papers in your welcome folders and knowledge gained through your expert panels to self-select into a roundtable topic. We're offering six topics from which to choose. First, which energy storage applications are likely most needed in Oregon? Second, what mechanisms could be used to accurately capture the multiple value streams that may result from energy storage? Third, what support tools are most needed in Oregon to spur development of energy storage projects? Fourth, what demonstration projects would be most beneficial? Fifth, what technical challenges are holding utilities back from installing energy storage? And sixth, what opportunities exist to spur energy storage projects through reforms related to financing and tax policy? We hope that you select a roundtable topic from which you'll not only learn, but also a topic where you may use your own experiences and knowledge to contribute towards answering these important questions and reaching the desired outcome. After the hour and a half of roundtable sessions, we'll take a break for more Great Portland Coffee and regroup to hear a report out on outcomes of the roundtable topics. With the help of our workshop partner, the University of Oregon School of Law, we hope to post information about the outcomes of each roundtable topic on our workshop website. Now I'll turn to our keynote. We're incredibly fortunate to have Dr. Imre Juk here today as keynote speaker to share his thoughts on energy storage. Imre directs the Energy Storage Research Program at the U.S. Department of Energy, which funds work on a variety of technologies such as advanced batteries, flywheels, supercapacitors, and compressed air energy storage. Applications include seamless continuity of power supply for high-tech industry during outages, making renewable energy dispatchable, and helping to increase the capacity factor and ease congested distribution lines. Work under his direction has received seven R&D 100 awards. He's also responsible for the $185 million ARRA stimulus program in energy storage, which has also attracted substantial cost shares from industry and venture capital. Imre got his bachelor's degree from Fordham University, and he did graduate work at Brown University, where he was a research assistant to Nobel laureate Leon Cooper. He has a PhD in theoretical physics from Purdue University and became a research associate at Syracuse University. He has taught physics, civil engineering, and architecture at the University of Wisconsin and Kuwait University. Please join me in welcoming Imre.
Well, good morning. It's a pleasure to be here in the misty Northwest. Almost thought I wouldn't make it because yesterday, Washington, D.C. airport was covered in 7 inches of snow. Even as I was taking off, they were de-icing the plane for an hour, and I almost didn't make it last evening. Anyway, let me try and figure out, do we have somebody who can put my slides on?
I hate futzing with computers other than my own. There it is.
to talk to you about energy storage, and I put in grid energy storage because, you know, I'm talking about sizable quantities of it. And it's called Progress Towards Commercialization because I'm not interested in just talking about technologies and laboratory results. I'm trying to gear it clearly towards commercially applicable and viable technology. Now, it's gratifying to have a room this big full of people having at least some interest in energy storage, because 10 years ago, that would have been a very difficult thing to do. If you told the utility that you were interested in energy storage, they would say, energy what? Except, of course, for pumped hydro, which has been around for quite a while and has been a mainstay of utilities that have it, and it's extremely useful. But in the last 10 years, to a not inconsiderable degree due to our work, energy storage has become one of the hottest topics in the electricity business. So, what is storage? Energy storage provides energy when it is needed, just as transmission provides energy where it is needed. Now, transmission, of course, is a huge industry, and it has created a tremendous network of generation and distribution in the US. Storage, not so much, even though the idea is very, it's a very obvious idea, time and space. But in recent years, something new is occurring. We have variable generation of sizable quantities. Now, it used to be that the load was varying because, you know, we are diurnal animals. So the utilities could adjust their output. But now we have not only the load, but part of the generation is variable also. So what we need is we need a buffer in between, and that buffer is energy storage. It's not only that. As I said, the US electric grid is a technological marvel. But it doesn't always work. If you look at the map, lower right hand, you see that big black spot on the East Coast that corresponds to the outage of August 2003. 5 million, 5 million people out of electricity. And this is true for other grids too. India, for example, July 2012, 670 million people out of electricity. The thing is, any unbuffered, stressed, complex system is inherently vulnerable to collapse. The bigger the system, the more complex the system, the more serious the collapse when it does occur, and sooner or later it will occur, at least in regions of it. So again, we need a buffer. Quick look at what's happening elsewhere in the world. US, 2.5% are in storage, and that's pumped hydro mostly. Europe, 10%. Japan, 15%. Rough numbers, and don't quote me. Well, guess which country has the most outages? Well, we do. So, you know, the implication is we really do need more storage if we want to firm our grid. And that is becoming a reality. Energy storage is coming on. If you look at the list on the left, some large storage projects, sizable, I mean, not all of them are in the United States. You know, I start with Fairbanks, beautiful system, 27 megawatts, probably the world's largest still. Rokkasho, Japan, 34 megawatts, and then it goes on. Laurel Mountain, a beautiful system by AES. Steventown, one of my own. Hebei, China, somewhat inaccurately called the world's largest storage unit. And then others, No Trees, Tehachapi coming up, and Modesto. The Chinese Energy Storage Association, who produce a beautiful brochure on a monthly basis, tracks these projects. And as you can see, between May of 2011 to, well, now, energy storage has grown up from 370 megawatt to 738 megawatt. And these are built projects, built on-grid projects. They are not just proposed things. How exactly they figure this, I don't know, because there are other sources that have much larger numbers. They may include very small projects, or however. But I like those because they are listed and known projects. Now, to help this process along a little bit, we managed to garner an ARRA stimulus grant, funding for storage demonstration projects. And we got $185 million for my program, which is sizable for storage, even though other programs like Smart Grid received hugely bigger amounts. But what I'm proud of is that we managed to get $585 million in cost share for our $185 million. It means that industry and utilities are interested and willing to come up with their own money. And that's what counts. You know, you can throw money on the street, but you know, unless people participate and really need it, it's a waste. So we have 16 projects, 4 are completed, 4 more are nearly completed. What do we want to do with these projects? Well, first we want to show technical feasibility. You know, it's not just piling batteries on top of each other. It's getting a system going. It's always the system. It isn't individual battery technology. We want to gather cost data because the cost of these systems is largely unknown. Battery costs are easy. You can buy them on the market. But how much the system actually costs is a different matter. We want to stimulate regulatory change because the regulatory system is not set up for a concept like storage. The regulatory system looks at transmission, distribution, generation. Okay, that's what it knows. It's slowly beginning to learn to handle wind and solar. But law students, listen up. There is really, as yet, no completely coherent structure of regulation for storage. But it's coming. And finally, I want to generate follow-on projects. I don't just want people to take money and do a project. I want them to take that money and, after they've built the project, I want them to build other commercial projects that I don't have to pay for. I should remind you also, because people often say, well, batteries are all over the place, you know. Well, you've got consumer products, you've got hybrid electric vehicles, the military and utility. The scales are vastly different, and the economics is quite different. For consumer products, you're willing to pay a lot because, well, you want one, okay? For utilities, it's got to be down to the nearest cent, okay? So cost, the urgency for cost effectiveness is much higher at the upper end. And the needs are different, the footprint and what have you. So there are energy storage systems and there are power storage systems. Power are the fast ones. Energy are the long ones. Okay, if you want to do address that peak during the day that Commissioner Savage mentioned, you want energy. If you want to smooth solar, you want power. And these are the various technologies that we are involved in. Important chart on the right hand. If you go through all the ISOs in the US, the amount of power available from renewable energy during peak period is about 10% of the nominal capacity. Okay, so it's nice to say I have a megawatt. Well, you only have, 100 really. A large project, 25 megawatts, 3-hour battery, Primus Power. If you look at the box, you can see that a calculation of the economic benefits of gas turbines versus storage. Storage wins hands down. Fast projects, power. Thank you. Yes, I get it. Power jiggles around all the time. Okay. Well, we have projects for those too. In this case, flywheels. Okay. 20 megawatts of flywheels. And that is the project which provided the basis for FERC to establish pay for performance. That's how you generate regulatory change. You first have to build it and then go to FERC. Safety, important. We are starting on a safety initiative. And it's growing. We have an international database that we maintain, and we now have 844 energy storage projects from 49 countries on it. Goal is to make energy storage ubiquitous on the electric grid. Thank you.
Thank you, Imre. Imre has kindly accepted our request to stay on as a panelist for our first panel on energy storage projects in Oregon and the Northwest. I'd like to invite our panelists to come up to the front to take their seats, Wayne, Joe, Dennis, Jason, Tom, Lee, and Imre. They represent a broad spectrum of experts ranging from utilities, developers, to agencies that will help us understand the energy storage landscape in Oregon and the Northwest through current and proposed projects. Their presentations will focus on their project's energy storage technology, why it was selected, how it may be performing the intended storage applications, and barriers and solutions to project deployment. I'll take my seat soon and let the panelists present, but first I'll ask the panelists to pass the mic, or in this case, the spotlight on a college lectern, to each other after presentations. After Jason and Tom's presentation, I'll come back up to moderate and facilitate questions from all of you in the audience. So please note your questions down as the presentations occur for the end of the presentations. First up is Wayne.
Well, thank you very much for the opportunity to come and speak and tell you a little bit about our Salem Smart Power Project that enfolds a very large battery. I appreciate very much what Commissioner Savage said about the ability to have excess and absorb renewable power, and this battery can indeed do some of that. I will have to go back and tell our crew that a lot of what they've been working on for the last 5 years is all there to pop a pimple, and so I'm sure they'll be thrilled. That'd be great. This is our battery project. This is a project that was part of the Pacific Northwest Smart Grid demonstration. It's a 5-megawatt lithium-ion battery, 1.25 megawatt hours. You can do a lot of things with it. One of the things is just firming and shaping our feeder load. We have designed this thing, and it was funded out in the smart grid RF spending, not in the energy storage area, as far as I know. So we designed it with 5 assets in place as part of this contract. One, we can go microgrid. We have the potential to do that. We had put in 2 different types of demand response, both commercial and residential. We actually put in some advanced detection switches that are capable of being automated to produce more resiliency into this feeder. And then finally, and this is really the goal of this particular project, each of these nodes that we'll talk about, 11 utilities, ours included, can respond to a financial signal to actually turn on these assets, turn them off, depending on the information that is received, analyzed, and it's all done computer to computer. There is no human in the loop. That's transactive control. So really quick, it's in Salem, Oregon. It's on our rural feeder line. It's our partners, Battelle, BPA. Grateful very much for the US DOE funding. It's a $178 million overall project. It was a gleam in the eye in 2009. 2014, it's essentially almost all history now. But there it is. Did a lot of prototype testing down at NRL in Colorado. Most of this testing involved parking the battery next to an inverter and then trying it out. And then we repeated it again in Salem, and it's amazing what you find when you do that, and lots of lessons learned when you run into that type of a project. We are now in the process of responding to the transactive energy signal. Doing a lot of after-action reports and helping Battelle and our partners assemble a rather large database. Costing $25 million overall for us is about $6.5 million. So for every dollar we put up, our customers' funding, $3 from external funding showed up. I'm not much of a shopper, but even I'll take a deal like that, and it's a 75% discount. So this is what it looked like before. This is what it looked like after. This is an 8,000 square foot building. If you are impressed, this is a 5 megawatt lithium ion battery that has landscaping around it. This is the basic building block of the unit. It's not really much larger than a car automobile battery, but close to 50 volts per module. It is lithium ion. Just to show you how far we've come, this is Professor Volta's original battery, a metal disc separated by cardboard soaked in salt water, circa 1800. Don't know how long it'll last, but then again, what would you put as a load across this? Who knows, I mean. But nonetheless, in the ensuing couple hundred years, major technological advances, not least of which is we turned it on its side and put a box around it, so there it is. But nonetheless, lots of stacking, and this is the way it's actually built. We have four of these modules per drawer, and then we actually stack the drawers together up like this, and virtually all the batteries that you'll see are designed like this. Lithium ion comes with a bit of a reputation, so we spend a lot of time on fire control, fire detection, extensive safety procedures. The one I'll just focus on a little bit after you read this list here is we actually designed uniquely a rupturable tube that actually intertwines throughout all the battery racks. There is a red pressurized can on top of these racks, but you'll see a little bit later. And should it encounter that tube, encounter a flame, it will actually rupture. That can will discharge and extinguish the local flame. That's the extent of which we have gone to make sure this thing is in good operating safe condition. This is serial number one for Portland General Electric. As far as I know, for a battery this size, it's serial number one in Oregon. So when you look at the rack there as we build up this thing, you'll see one drawer with three disconnects on them. This is where the CPU is located. This battery comes with a brain. It tells us in brutal detail how it's feeling. And we try to address those health issues and feelings as much as we can. And this is something that Professor Volta would not have recognized. 20 sets of inverter cabinets and isolation transformers. A little bit of an anecdote. When we started to do robustness testing this last year, really working the system hard to make sure that it would do what we think it should do and be safe and reliable. Only one thing broke, and that was one of the transformers. This is technology that if Thomas Edison had walked in the door, he'd recognize. Everything else, I don't know, what is that? But that was the only thing that broke, so go figure. With obvious gratitude to Professor Bolton, this is what it actually looks like then in a rather nice photograph. And you can see those red pressurized cans way up on top to add to safety and fire control. Modes of operation, on grid, it can function by absorbing energy or putting it back out. We can do that in a peak shaving mode, as Commissioner Savage mentioned. We can do that either supported by our system, and I mentioned it can go microgrid up to a point, and in this case, we can actually engage the distributed standby generators that I'll show you in a bit. And then we can actually go microgrid if we want. In this case, we can disconnect and go and tie in these three dispatchable standby generators that are in the neighborhood on the feeder and do it that way too. Here are the distributed standby generators. PGE has a very unique program in this respect. We have about 100 megawatts of this now. Diesels in this case, but you could easily see solar and wind come into place into the future. We're actually working on solar right now, but these are the sizes of the units, their location. The normal feeder load is about 2.5 megawatts, so we have more than plenty of power here to do that. This is creeping way back in the back of your mind, I don't doubt. How does this thing operate? We can tell you now with some confidence. First question out of my mouth about a year and a half ago, how many cycles is this thing going to have? Well, we're really not sure. All right, it's okay. It's a fair answer to a fair question. We think we have a better answer now, and that's great. After doing the stress tests and the prototype testing, this thing will shut off at design temperature of 40 degrees centigrade. But it is lithium ion. You want to keep it within a band of about 20 to 80% of life of the battery. It turns out the manufacturer underpromised and will overperform likely because it turns out really this is closer to a 2 megawatt hour battery, and so this is really quite nice. We're targeting about 3,000 cycles or about 10-year lifespan, so we can know the depreciable life. Round-trip efficiency. Electrons coming in from the grid, passing all the way through the battery, coming back out to do some work, 90%, which is fairly typical for lithium ion. And one of the several reasons why you'd look at lithium ion for certain applications, very good power density, very good energy density, very good life. So in the future, this year, next year, we'll be looking at a variety of use and valuation tests. We have to finish our contractual requirement with Mattel this year with the U.S. government. But these are some of the tests we'll be looking at, demand response, some of the things that Commissioner Savage raised. We're not quite certain what number 8 is yet, although that got mentioned, so we just left it in the notes. But you know, do a big defined excursion test to be defined. We're not sure what that means at this point, but everybody agrees it sounds like fun. So at any rate, I think I'm done here in 10 minutes. And so one of the lessons learned that we have is that it just takes over a five-year project, roughly, lots of folks to make this happen. Here are just the list of the internal partners to make this happen. I'd like to point out Conrad Eustace. When I mentioned the gleam in the eye, a lot of it was his eyeball. So yeah, Conrad, you ought to raise your hand. Yeah, he deserves a lot of credit here. Thank you very much.
Wayne, I'll call Joe up.
Good morning. My name is Joe Everhart, and I'm here to speak about pump storage hydropower, in particular the project that my company is working on called Swan Lake in southern Oregon. EDF Renewable Energies is the project that's working, the company that's working on the Swan Lake project. This is a company that's an outgrowth of EDF in France. And the focus so far has been namely on solar and wind energy development in the United States. We're now looking to get into pump storage as a way to support wind and solar. Storage market drivers. Today we're talking about storage. The grid is an ever-changing place. Impacts for flexibility on the grid at this time are coming from decreases in flexibility from environmental and species restrictions in traditional hydropower projects. For thermal facilities, we're having increase NOx and SOx emission controls, which reduce their flexibility as well as their maximum power output. And we have the intermittent resources that are coming in from renewables, both wind and solar have high fluctuations. Pump storage and any type of storage has the ability to help mitigate that to some degree. Renewables are difficult to predict their energy that is created. And one impact in particular in the Northwest is the minimum load challenge, which is when supply exceeds demand. So you find a time, especially during the second quarter of the year, where renewable energies are producing electricity, hydropower is coming in at full strength, and load is at its weak point. When supply exceeds demand, prices start to fall, and one unique thing that we're finding here in the Northwest is negative pricing impacts that show up in the marketplace. Storage can help mitigate that, find a place for the energy so we don't have to deal with negative price impacts in the market, and provide that power back to the market at a time when it is needed. So various types of storage technologies will be described today. Pump storage hydro is one that kind of spans the spectrum of time frames when energy and capacity is needed. Everywhere from seconds to minutes to hours to a day, potentially a couple days, usually giving the economics of pump storage and the capital costs that are required for it, multi-day storage or the traditional type of hydro storage we've seen in the Northwest of up to a week is usually impractical. But pump storage, unlike some of the other technologies, can provide both duration, this was the energy component that was spoken about earlier, as well as power, which is the more near-term immediate need for energy. If you look at the different types of market opportunities and where pump storage can fit in, it has black start capabilities. So when we look at reliability, one of our key initial aspects that we're looking for, providing grid stability. In the very short term, we have system frequency control, restrictive reactive power, voltage support. And as we look at managing both the load of the system in a dynamic way, pump storage can provide that benefit. Or if we're looking at managing specifically a generator or a set of generators dynamically, pump storage has the way of pulling that excess energy from those facilities, storing it, and returning it at a later time. Of course, much like traditional hydropower, and I like to compare pump storage as much as I can to traditional hydropower, it has many of the same flexibilities and operating characteristics. I provide spinning reserve, non-spinning reserve, supplemental reserve. And when looking at valuation, the last two items here, the time spread, most people think of valuing pump storage from the perspective of putting in off-peak cheap energy and returning it back to the market during on-peak hours. These other types of characteristics of very short-term flexibility for the grid are also value streams that are potential. And in the developing markets of the near future will provide opportunities for pump storage to play. This is a diagram of a typical pump storage facility. This is a closed loop facility. Pump storage can have a river draft, which they have to return the water back to the river at a later time. The project we're proposing at Swan Lake in southern Oregon, this is near Klamath Falls, is a closed loop system. Its water is not coming from a river. It is pulled from underground aquifers that provides the initial charge of water as well as any makeup water that's required. And then it's a closed loop system, so there's no impacts on fish, other types of species. It's a very contained system. Effectively, water is pumped from the lower reservoir to the upper reservoir when energy is consumed. Our facility is expected to be a 600 megawatt generation facility. On the off-peak, the actual energy consumed, it'll pull about 720 megawatts of electricity as a load, and then return that as up to 600 megawatts of generation capacity when needed. Wayne talked about efficiency. 90%, I believe, on lithium ion. With pumped hydro, we have a little lower efficiency than that. We're at about 80% for the turbine system itself, and then for the overall project, approximately 75%, dealing with step-up transformer, radial line, line losses, And so for every megawatt that goes in, we get about 0.75 megawatts back out of the facility. EDF, in looking at putting pumped storage hydro in the United States, is leaning on its long history of expertise and its parent company in building dams and pumped storage throughout France. EDF is the primary utility in the country of France. And as many utilities in France have done, they've looked around the world to expand and spread their expertise. Hydropower is one of those key expertise for EDF, and we're looking to leverage that here. EDF's involvement in pumped storage around the world is fairly substantive. They have almost a little over 7,000 megawatts of commissioned projects at this time, about 5,000 megawatts of projects that are under construction. And the Swan Lake facility, this will be our first project in the United States. Pump storage is not new to the United States. This diagram, this figure here, shows the pump storage facilities are currently in existence. And what you'll find along the eastern seaboard is that there's quite a few pump storage facilities there. This is in response to the nuclear build-out primarily of the 60s and 70s. Baseload facilities in nuclear that needed a place for their off-peak energy to be economic. So the Swan Lake project, as I said, is located in Klamath, near Klamath Falls. It's not actually at the Swan Lake lake itself, the natural feature. It's going to be a self-contained project just north of there. The project has a little over 1,200 feet of head. That's the elevation difference. And that's one of the key factors that we need for developing pump storage. You need a location that has a great elevation difference. And at the same time, you need geography at the top and the bottom of that escarpment or the cliff that allows for low-cost civil works to put in the reservoirs for both the upper reservoir and the lower reservoir. And lastly, I want to talk about valuation of storage in general, but also as it applies to pump storage. Three key things that are not currently valued typically in utilities plans for pump storage, and that is transmission benefits, greenhouse gas benefits, and the portfolio effect. In short, the transmission benefit is storage allows the opportunity for greater utilization of existing transmission lines and avoidance of creating and deploying capital to new transmission lines. For the greenhouse gases, there's actually two benefits. One is an overgeneration from renewables. Pump storage provides a home for that. I spoke of that already. That allows for all those greenhouse gas benefits that would have been otherwise curtailed. It allows them to be created and help reduce the overall greenhouse gas emissions. Secondly, on this point, for all the peaking and flexible thermal resources that are displaced and allowed to run in more of a base load or static basis, their emissions are improved or their emissions are avoided entirely through the flexibility that storage can provide. And finally, the portfolio effect. All storage is a load, and therefore it has the ability to take additional energy from the system and sink it, and that provides new economic opportunities for existing power plants as well. So thank you for your time.
Thanks, Joe. Can I have Dennis come up now?
First of all, let me thank the organizers of this workshop. I think it's very rich in material and full. You know, there's an old joke about nuclear power, particularly fusion, hot fusion, looks really good in about 15 years. 20 years later, looks really good in about 15 years. And often, I've been in this game in one capacity or another for a few decades now, and I'm hoping that the story for energy storage is not the same as the story for hot fusion, and we'll hope that we can get there a little faster. I'd like to go over Pacific Corp, who we are, our core principles, our experience with energy storage, it does go back quite a ways, and our view on energy storage today. We have 1.8 million customers. We're across six states. You can see Northern California, a lot of places in Oregon, Southern Washington, a lot of distribution, transmission, generation. In particular, as it applies to energy storage, we're part of Mid-American Energy Holdings Company, and or MEHC. And a couple of years ago, they formed a Mid-American Renewables Company. You can see that's outlined there in that little graphic just above Pacific Corp. And MEHC, by the end of 2014, will own 8% of the wind capacity in the USA and 20% of the solar capacity in the USA. These are generally very large projects and in California and parts southwest. We also have a company just below Pacific Corp in that graphic, Northern Power Grid in Northern England. We've been paying attention to their project. They're part of a huge smart grid project in that part of the world. And if you want to Google search on CLNR, that's for customer-led network revolution, they call it. Then you'll see more details about that. In a city called Darlington in northern England, they have a 5 megawatt hour facility. It's lithium-based. Pacific Corp seeks balance among its core principles, and they're down in the lower right there. And this is who we are. This is just part of us. So as we look at any energy storage or other project, it has to achieve a balanced outcome of these six objectives. It has to be good for our customers. We need to be able to operate it with excellence. We have to have sufficient employee talent to take care of it. Regulators need to give us an okay on it. It needs to be environmentally sound and sustainable. And sustainability we sometimes overlook, but I'm glad to see there's a big focus on cost here. That's, it can't break the bank for the utility or anybody else. Well, historically, a lot of you may be old enough to remember when just-in-time manufacturing was a big thing. It was good to manufacture and then deliver your product directly to the customers. Well, the utilities have been doing that for over 100 years. And the big advantage is that you don't need a warehouse to store your product in. And now we're going to a situation where we're building a warehouse for electricity. We're building warehouses. And we're building warehouses after the product has been turned into electricity. It's not that it hasn't been stored, it's just after it's turned into electricity now it's being stored. And typically the storage has been in the form of raw materials, hydro reservoirs, chemical storage, bonds at the fuel and power plants. And one that's really important that has been talked about, at least in engineering circles just recently, and that's the collective rotating mass of the interconnected power system. There is some storage there, and there are some advantages to that inertia. Well, if we have wind and solar PV as intermittent sources, this requires storage after it's been turned into electricity. And this step is costly, just like building a warehouse is costly. But we seem to be going there as a society, and so we've been looking hard at that. And so the message there is if you have to build a warehouse, you ought to build one that meets your needs and do it as cost-effectively as possible, and that's out of deference to the customers, those who pay the electricity rates. So on the theme of something that's as cost-effective as possible, you can see some different technologies here, and I like to look at this diagram as a bunch of racehorses. You're up above, and you're looking down at these racehorses, and they're moving down, and the finish line is there at the bottom, and we see that there on the lower right, pumped hydro got there first, so they won the race, and I appreciated the presentation on pumped hydro. So that's the most cost-effective way to do it. So why are we looking at all the rest of these racehorses? Why would we want to put our money down there? Well, pumped hydro isn't available everywhere, and it doesn't meet all the needs. So we look at some of these that are a little more targeted. And we've actually done some projects at Pacific Corp. We did one back in the early 90s with lead acid. We partnered with the with Sandia National Laboratories and the National Park Service to put a hybrid facility in on beautiful Lake Powell in southern Utah. We did it so that actually the use case, as the term is now called, was pretty good. They were paying what we figured was about 37 cents per kilowatt hour to get their power to Dangling Rope Marina. And at that price, it didn't take a whole lot to beat that. Well, if you're going to make a use case for what we're doing to augment or supplant, in some cases, the kinds of powers that the kinds of rates that we normally pay here, we have to come up with a whole different way of doing it. I'd like to also mention in light blue, long-duration flywheels and flow batteries are pretty interesting. They seem like they have a potential to come down in cost. In particular, on flywheels, look along the bottom. This is the lifetime. This is the number of cycles you can get out of them. They're pretty good. And so also is their efficiency. All right, fast forward to 2001. We have a classic case down in southern Utah. 85-mile-long rattlesnake feeder had a rattlesnake substation at 25 kV just east of Moab. 61 miles as the crow flies. It was surrounded by national parks and other vistas, sensitive environments. Permitting is extremely difficult in that area. And there were new load requests in Castle Valley up at the top there, right at the end of the line. And we had to deny some of those load requests. And we also had reliability issues because it was such a long line. Load was higher in the daytime, largely for air conditioning. And it was a classic day-night storage case. We were owned by Scottish Power at the time, and it was decided that it was time. Now, this is about 2002 when we got this project started, so it was very early compared to some of the later projects we see today. We compared several technologies and decided on the vanadium redox flow battery technology. Projected capital expenditure is $525 per kilowatt hour, 250 kilowatt, 2 megawatt hour design. We had early adopter issues. So it worked, but it wasn't all that reliable. We had high parasitic load. One thing that wasn't fully appreciated is that you needed to cool the facility in which the batteries were stored. And by batteries, I mean the electrolyte. That's the difference in a flow battery. Then in the lower right, we see that those are the electrolyte tanks where we stored the electrolyte that stored the energy. And we had to cool that building, and that was considerable in parasitic load. It was a remote site, and whenever you're going to do high tech at a very remote site, you're asking for trouble if you're right on the edge of technology. We also had our supplier had some business issues. The actual capital expenditure turned out to be $925 per kilowatt hour, and it was determined that we could have rebuilt the line for about half the cost of putting in that facility. So that caused us to kind of pull back a little bit for a couple of years. Then we were approached in 2010 by EMB Energy. You see down in the lower left, Dr. Richard Post of Lawrence Livermore National Laboratories was the one that came up with that invention. It's basically a flywheel, but it's very high tech, with a flywheel spinning in vacuum, passive magnetic bearings as opposed to active, and electrostatic motor generator as opposed to electromagnetic. The big thing that we liked was it was promising to significantly drive down the cost of flywheel products. And those have a lot of advantages if the costs can be driven down. and the regulators and our integrated resource plan was fully informed. A demo site, if they pass certain hurdles, was selected in northern Utah. And things were going really well. Innovative, fresh ideas, promising science and engineering. But EMB Energy was venture capital funded. They lost their funding, and the project had to be canceled. I still believe that what was explored in that particular project has great merit. So our outlook for the future, to end up here, we will embrace energy storage, and we are embracing energy storage, if it helps us provide safe and reliable power to our customers, and it meets those balanced outcomes. That means the price is right. A new, fully developed technology serves our customers better than alternatives. It has minimal impact on the environment, and we have regulatory approval and rate recovery. So we are open to ideas, and I thank you for your time.
Thank you, Dennis. I'm going to invite Jason and then Tom up.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Jason Ziskowski. I'm from the Snohomish County Public Utility District. Snohomish County PUD is located about 30 minutes north of Seattle. We have about 324,000 customers, and one of the unique things about the Snohomish County PUD is we are committed to meeting all future load growth with non-fossil fuel-based generation resources. We also have a renewable portfolio standard in Washington that we must meet. So with this challenge to integrate increasing amounts of intermittent renewables, we began to get interested in energy storage. And here you can see some of the potential benefits that we see of energy storage. One of them, integrating renewables, other things such as peak shaving, energy arbitrage, essentially time shifting of energy for energy balancing and so on and so forth. Volt VAR optimization on the distribution grid, and then also possible capital deferral, investment deferral. So a couple of years ago, we began looking at energy storage, talked to a lot of battery suppliers, power conversion system suppliers, other utilities, system integrators, and what we found were that systems were expensive, they lacked modularity. You couldn't just go out and buy some batteries from vendor X and a power conversion system from vendor Y and get them to work together. But there's a lot of reoccurring engineering that goes on in every project to get the batteries, the power conversion systems, to integrate. And then there's not a standard way that those integrate upwards into the utility. One of our goals was to get the energy storage system integrated into our SCADA system and then also have it be a asset that could be easily dispatched by our power scheduling folks. And so with those things in mind, we started what we call the MESA, the Modular Energy Storage Architecture, to try to bring some standardization to utilities. Typically when utilities go out and buy equipment, they specify a lot of IEEE standards in their specifications. And today when you look at energy storage, those standards don't exist to specify. So you kind of get this gap between the utilities and the manufacturers. The manufacturers have this great product. They're not quite clear on the use cases, and the utilities aren't quite sure what they're getting or what they're buying. So we wanted to bring some solutions to that gap and hopefully drive down costs by creating some standards and getting rid of that reoccurring engineering. So we see a tremendous potential for energy storage, but significant challenges. And with that, you know, anytime you have challenges, you have opportunities. And so we have partnered up with One Energy Systems to try to further the MESA standard and bring standardization to energy storage. The first system we're working on right now is a 1 megawatt, half a megawatt hour system. that we'll deploy at our Hardison substation. It's just about a mile from our operations center. And we will demonstrate a multi-vendor solution there of batteries, power conversion system, based on MESA standards, and have it integrated into our SCADA system and be dispatchable by our power schedulers. One thing, in talking to other utilities who have done storage projects, we found that, you know, they bought the energy storage system to meet a specific use case. Then when they got it, they found that the control system didn't really implement the use case that well. So some utilities ended up going and trying to rig up their own control systems with typical utility automation products. And, you know, we want to get away from that and have a control system that's flexible and that we can modify and kind of tune in that use case to really meet it well. So our project, we're in the detailed design right now and moving into the testing phase. We're doing a lot of interoperability testing right now, and then we'll be deploying later this summer and fall. And here's just kind of an overview of our project here. Like I said, we're working with One Energy Systems and also a few other partners. Alstom supplies our SCADA system, so they're involved as well. With that, I'll turn it over to Tom from One Energy Systems.
Thank you, Jason, and good morning, everybody. So just briefly, One Energy Systems, we are a software company in Seattle, Washington. We provide software that is the control system and an optimization system and the system for connecting energy storage into utilities, IT, and OT systems. What I want to focus on, though, is the effort that Snohomish has initiated to help bring standards to the supply chain in the energy storage industry. So I want to dive into that in just a little bit of detail. So when you look at an individual energy storage system, there's three main components. There's the battery, there's the power conversion system, and there's some other what we call balance of system, HVAC, switching, fire suppression, and so forth. Like any type of hardware, you need standards to have this supply chain be optimized to bring the lowest cost, the most reliable equipment, and also enable the suppliers to be able to do what they do best. What we don't want to have is have battery companies try to be software vendors, PCS companies try to become battery companies. So you need standards to enable integration. And perfect analogy there is the computer industry. Without the standards that we have for things like Bluetooth and so forth, we wouldn't have the growth that we have today. So one set of standards for the modular energy storage architecture are these standards that you see here, which are what we call inside the box or inside the energy storage system. The MESA Alliance organization, which there's a website for mesastandards.org, we have also partnered with an organization called SunSpec, which is developing standards in the solar PV industry. And they developed a number of standards around connecting with power conversion systems. So we're bringing together our standards efforts in that regard in this particular area. So the other dimension for standards is how do you take energy storage and connect it into a utility's IT and OT backplane, if you will. So the image that you see on the right is a representation of the variety of different sizes of storage that you might see on the grid or on the other side of the meter. So SES stands for substation energy storage, CES stands for community energy storage, and then on the other side of the meter would be distributed or sometimes residential energy storage. And so what utilities need are standard interfaces between those storage systems and their grid control systems like SCADA and power scheduling systems. Again, the analogy here would be the internet. Without the standards that developed on how do you connect all those computers together, we would not have the system we have today. To give a visual of what Snohomish has wanted to develop in the industry, is if you can imagine a utility going out there and trying to buy energy storage, and you've got all these different vendors with all kinds of different proprietary systems, and if you try to connect all of those proprietary systems into your existing SCADA and DMS systems, it's just impossible to manage. It just won't happen. And so the vision is to transform the market so that regardless of who the vendors are, and this is not to say this is we're expecting one vendor to control everything, but regardless of who the vendors are, they'll have standard ways of not only building the system inside the box, but then also connecting to the distribution utility systems. So Snohomish, to their credit, began their initial energy storage project with one of their main goals to transform the marketplace. In the state of Washington, we have an exciting opportunity because the state legislature has enacted the Washington Clean Energy Fund, and the Washington Department of Commerce is in the process of reviewing a number of applicants, distribution utility applicants, great projects that have been proposed. And the goals of this fund are to really, there's several goals, to support the clean technology development at the commercialization stage. So let me give two examples. One Energy in developing our control system, what we're going to be doing is developing not only all of the algorithms for optimizing the energy storage use. One of the key things with energy storage is how do you capture multiple value streams, but also combining that with demand response. So what we're going to be putting together is a holistic system to allow a distribution utility to maximize these new assets on the grid. Another exciting opportunity that the Washington Clean Energy Fund is going to enable is the demonstration of some great new battery technology. So an example is Uni Energy. They're located in Mukilteo, Washington. They're really the representation of some of these new battery chemistry technologies with all-in-one applications. So Dr. Guke had mentioned energy applications and power applications. The Uni Energy battery is going to be able to do both and have especially the long-duration capability. We're hoping to develop a demonstration within the state of Washington of an infrastructure for energy storage that can be replicated throughout not only the U.S. but the world, and ultimately to really grow the energy storage market. So that's the goals of the Washington Clean Energy Fund and expanding out on the projects that have been started in the state. And with respect to MESA, again, the Module Energy Storage Architecture, the MESA goals are to transform the energy storage supply chain through technology, to give utilities real flexibility in terms of how they deploy and grow and scale energy storage, and which will help all of us who are in the supply chain, because the more we can grow that supply chain, the better off we'll be. And what CEF will do is really help these technologies be able to demonstrate their capabilities and get over the early stage of development. Give utilities practical experience in deploying energy storage, and give us, with the companies in Washington, the opportunity to demonstrate the technologies and ultimately export that into growing markets like hopefully Oregon and obviously the state of California with their large mandate. Thank you.
Thanks, Jason and Tom. Next up, we have Lee.
Good morning, everyone. It's really valuable for me to be the last in line here because I've heard these great presentations and thinking about some common themes that we also support. You're going to hear me talk about a few of those. We just have four or five slides. And I also like to point out as I go along some great partners and project managers and folks that we're working with at BPA to move forward with energy storage pilots. I also like to emphasize we're going to talk a little bit about not just electric energy storage, but other ways to store energy. And we've already heard a shout out for Conrad Eustace. He's not just an evangelist, he's more than an evangelist for electric water heater, thermal storage, and if you want to hear more about it, please talk to him. I encourage you to talk with him, and we believe in the same sort of thought process about harvesting and looking at all forms of energy storage. In fact, one of the things we've heard a lot about cost effectiveness, but one of the things that we think about is how do we use existing processes, equipment, thermal energy opportunities to leverage those with existing infrastructure rather than building a brand new something, whatever that happens to be. Another theme that you're going to hear about today from our standpoint is this idea, I think Lisa mentioned it, is the partnership that comes, not just a financial partnership with cost sharing, but all the projects that you're hearing about today, from the one that Wayne talked about. We're very proud to be part of that smart grid demonstration project. That's a 50-50 match with Department of Energy funds, and that happens to be the largest smart grid demonstration project in the country, and I'm pleased to say it's also the largest demonstration by megawatts of electric battery storage in the Pacific Northwest. So we're very pleased and proud to be part of that. So just going forward, didn't know it had that transition. Neat. So I'm going to talk about what we have in flight right now, but I also want to point out that we at BPA, I see Steve Knutson, if you could raise your hand, who's been involved in compressed air energy storage studies. Pretty rigorous studies have been sponsored by BPA. We've looked at pump storage opportunities and evaluated that, but I'm going to concentrate mostly on what we're doing today and what we think are some opportunities in the future. So multiple pilots with energy storage components. We completed a wind integration pilot with Ecofys, which is a company that has offices here in Oregon and Corvallis. And we use thermal energy storage and demand response to support wind integration. That was the primary purpose, but I'd like to say that some of the things we've heard earlier in the discussions are, it's not just energy storage. Let me start over. There's an intersection between demand response and energy storage that I believe should continue to grow. Traditionally, demand response has been, how do we manage that peak? And that's traditionally been the way it has been successfully addressed in much of the country. But demand response and energy storage, how do you fill the valley, or how do you shift load? How do you use load to potentially increase load or decrease load during a wind event? How do you do it for ancillary services, for example? How do you potentially use load to help your non-wire solutions in trying to offset either substation build-out or transmission line build-out, or as we saw from PacifiCorp, I really appreciated that I didn't know about that. How do you use energy storage to find cost-effective, specialized solutions to utility issues? And cost-effective, specialized really makes sense to us. So this Ecofys pilot, which I'll point out in a few minutes, it was actually a pilot that gained us and Ecofys a national award from the Peak Load Management Alliance in innovative applications of demand response and storage. And other technology innovation pilots that involve electric energy storage in multiple roles, and I'll talk about with one slide each for that Primus. You've already heard about that, but we have one in the Puget Sound Energy's territory in Bainbridge Island, and then the Powan Energy pilot. I'm pleased to say that Powan is located here in Tualatin, Oregon. Virgil, if you raise your hand, if you have questions about the Powan Energy project. And also, I call on people a lot, Thor Hinckley, who is our project manager for both of these energy storage pilots, if you'd like to talk to him about more specifics. And we've already heard about the partnership and the smart grid demonstration project. Besides the Portland General Electric investment and success, Benton County PUD and Idaho Falls Power have small-scale deployment of battery storage. Just one slide about the Primus Energy Flow battery project in Bainbridge Island, which is kind of more or less its own little microgrid, if you will, served by one feeder and two substations. There is a specific business case that Puget Sound Energy has created that shows that the use of this Primus Energy battery storage, which you've already seen a picture of this, it gets used a lot, the one on the lower left of the control system and the actual battery, this can be modularized. And the general thought here is, instead of building an extra substation in addition to the two that exist there, why not use this battery in 5 megawatts to 25, I think we say, to 20 megawatt storage capability to offset the need for an expensive substation that's not only a financial cost and rate impact, but also an environmental and customer cost, if you will, on Bainbridge Island, because the customers and ratepayers, people of Bainbridge Island, would prefer not to have a substation built. And that's the kind of thing that we see in all sorts of infrastructure decisions, distribution lines, substations, and you heard about some sensitive environmental issues when we start building and reinforcing our transmission lines. So we consider this to be a success. It is a niche opportunity. I prefer maybe not to use the term niche, but more specialized. We heard about that from our friends at the Department of Commerce up in the state of Washington. And we think this is a real real positive development. Again, co-funded, 50% cost share. We consider this to be a great partnership between the vendor in this case, Primus Energy, Puget Sound Energy, BPA, and others who are working on this. So Powin Energy, excuse me, lithium ion battery, we've tested it here locally in our BPA labs over in Vancouver. It's now it's deployed at the city of Richland. In fact, we just drove by it yesterday when we were up there on a site visit. And it's used for load shifting, peak demand reduction at Nine Canyon Wind Farm, which is operated by Energy Northwest. There's a managed schedule and then a ramp rate management. Again, these specialized applications, and it can be ramped up. The other neat thing about this is, which we kind of emphasize about being on wheels, it's a mobile system. You could take it to where you need it, whether backing up a big box store or a substation management or the wind farm. Again, specialized applications and the mobility of this and the potential of this that we think is very strong. So we've successfully completed that testing at Nine Canyon Wind Farm. PNNL is a partner with this, and we're very excited about this this opportunity. In fact, the next place it'll go is a solar PV energy facility or site at the Pacific Northwest National Labs up in Richland after the at the city of Richland, the utility does their use case studies. And again, I've heard the term use cases and specialized uses, and I think this is where we're going to get a lot of momentum at the customer level, at the utility level, and at the grid level. There's specialized uses. Now, a little bit about what I haven't heard too much about, and that is, you know, in all the slides we've seen is concentrated on pump storage, flywheel, compressed air, and of course electric energy storage via different types of technologies, lithium ion, lead battery, or lead acid and flow batteries. But again, I'm going to cite the evangelism of my colleague Conrad. Look, this is real. We've shown that the thermal storage, whether it's cold storage facilities, a thermal can be seen as a battery, if you will, that sometimes you can charge it up and sometimes you can discharge it when you need it on the grid. And the four areas that we looked at were HVAC controls, cold storage facilities, and there's a lot of these in the Pacific Northwest, thermal brick furnaces, and the residential water heaters. There are 1.7 million electric water heaters in BPA service territory alone, those utilities we serve. That's a lot of thermal storage that could potentially be used. And Conrad, could you remind me of how many in the Pacific Northwest? 3.4 million, and you start doing the numbers, and that turns out to be more than just a couple megawatts of potential. But how do you get there? You have to do that with cost-effective solutions that serve the customer, serve the utilities, serve the region. So we have a ways to go there, but the two places where we see the most potential is in cold storage and residential water heaters from this pilot. We provide DR and balancing services while benefiting end-use customers. And this next slide is just a little bit of a summary. You see an installation there on with a demand response unit for a large water heater, 105-gallon water heater with a Steffes mixing valve and so on. We did test two types of technology, Steffes technology, and a lot of you have heard of that company. They're actually working a lot of pilots and demonstration projects across the country. In both and have a lot of application in the Midwest and beyond. What you see in the middle there, the line is what we call the balancing reserve deployed signal. This is what we have to deploy from the hydro system. It goes up and down depending on whether you need to increase generation or decrease generation. And those faint lines on top and bottom are the limits of the hydro system, roughly around 800 to 1,000 megawatts that we can provide for those balancing services. Unless we get pretty close. So the graph below, which is a little bit hard to read, but that shows with the blue line, the balancing reserve deployed on the what we call deck, or it's actually kind of opposite, but the how to increase load in response to a wind ramp or a wind event, which we measure by the balancing reserve deployed. And we were able to show that on the small scale deployment that electric water heaters and cold storage warehouses could respond to this successfully. Now, this is a pilot that shows it can be done and all the potential, and so we're thinking ahead to how do we move this into kind of a commercial demonstration rather than just a technology demonstration. but showed that water heater controls can enable higher control up and down. Loads showed the ability to move in response to this balancing reserve deployed signal. Again, Equifis was very strong project management here. And results that were adept at load up and down, that Spiray, who is another company we partnered with, modeling showed capability to effectively charge during light load hour events or light load hours, or pre-charge during light load hours. Again, this is this other use of energy storage to put it during light load hours when you have the generation. Might even be something that California would be interested in. And we think it's more promising as costs decrease. We're trying to be honest with ourselves about cost-effective solutions. Right now, the STEFA solution is a little bit expensive, a little bit of sticker shock. But as I said, there's 1.7 million electric water heaters in the Northwest and EPA service territory, and 3.4 million in the entire Pacific Northwest. That's a large thermal mass, distributed, but a large thermal mass that we think figures in this energy storage equation to a very large extent. So a little bit about opportunities. These are all the projects that you've seen are via the technology innovation process, the office that Terry Oliver heads at BPA. You can write this down. We are under a solicitation process right now asking for proposals. You can go in, see if your proposal or idea might meet some of the criteria. So this is a funding source, if you will. And it goes through a pretty rigorous review process, so we want to make sure everybody knows about these opportunities. And a couple of contact information, myself and Crystal Ball, who is the BPA constituent account executive for the state of Oregon. And I think she will be coming here later today. So with that, thank you very much.
Thank you, Lee. Welcoming back, Imre.
Well, good morning again. DOE has extensive experience of developing novel storage technologies in a spectrum of applications. We have explored just about every type of application there is. And I'll run through a few of them very quickly. Frequency regulation, that's the small blips and the nasty stuff that you get from solar and other renewables, but it's generated by the grid itself. Example project, ARA project by Duke Energy using extreme power battery. Now, I mentioned before that our 20-megawatt flywheel project established, together with projects by AES, the need for new regulation by FERC. Well, in ERCOT, of course, they don't follow FERC, so it was necessary to have a project there, too. And we have this very nice 36-megawatt project at a place called No Trees, Texas. As you can see, there are no trees there, but there are windmills, and now there are batteries, 36 megawatt of them. And this project, again, together with AES projects, was crucial as a pilot for ERCOT's consideration to establish something like pay for performance. Flow batteries. I consider flow batteries very promising, particularly when you take longer periods. You've already heard about Primus several times. We have a big project with them, 25 megawatt, which is under construction, but they've already constructed a few smaller ones. One is at a Marine Corps air station near San Diego. And this project, the smaller project, is there because the Marine Corps realized that they had to shut down whenever the electricity wasn't available from the grid. And so they put up PV. But PV and smart grid isn't enough to guarantee continuity. You need storage. And that's what they're doing. This one is the BPA Puget Sound Grid Project. PNNL has done the analysis to select cost-effective site and scale to optimize value stream. And Primus Power, of course, was developed under ARA funding. And as you can see, if you look at the stacks on the left-hand corner, the actual values are greater than the cost available for the project. So it's a cost-effective project. A technology that's coming up very fast, well, not very fast, it's we have our first installation coming up. This is EnerVault. They are using an iron chromium flow battery. And this is in the middle of the almond country in the Central Valley. When you go to it, you go through acres and acres for 2 hours of blossoming almond trees. It's very nice. And they have PV there, but the PV, of course, does not necessarily provide electricity when they need it for irrigation. So the flow battery will do that, and it will do it for a four-hour period. At PNL, right close by, there is a lot of research that we do. We also do research at Sandia. In particular, PNL developed a mixed acid electrolyte, which increases the energy density of flow batteries by a factor of two. We have licensed the technology to three technologies, Imergy, Joule Watt, and Uni Energy, a Washington company. And they also have a vanadium iron flow battery technology, which is licensed to a company called Artha. And Artha has contracted with PNL to scale up the system by a factor of 10. And here it is, the Washington State Clean Energy Fund, solicitation for $15 million, and of course $15 million in cost share for utility energy storage projects. And UET is participating in three of the proposals, providing use case analytics and benefits optimization. Sorry, that's written wrong. PNL is providing use case analytics and benefits of optimization. Anyway, Avista, Snohomish, and PNL again, their proposals. We'll see fairly soon which of these projects get selected. Advanced batteries. I am very fond of lead carbon batteries. Lead carbon batteries are very much like lead acid batteries, but they have carbon in one of the electrodes, and that increases the lifetime by a factor of 10. So you've got a lead acid battery at about the same, or a battery at about the same price as a lead acid battery, and you're getting into lithium-ion lifetimes. We have two projects in it, one with Public Service New Mexico. This is completed. And we are using that now to work on algorithms. And this is done by Public Service New Mexico, by Sandia, New Mexico State, University of New Mexico, and by the integrator eCOLT. We are building a gigantic system that will take into account the state of the grid, the economic signals, the state of the battery, and the forecast of solar and weather. So everything is in there. Another project, same technology at East Penn. This is bigger, 3 megawatts. For frequency regulation, or we can use it for load management. This one was commissioned in June 2012 and has already delivered over 700,000 kilowatt hours of regulation. And that project has an offspring too by Hydro Tasmania, who have installed Australia's largest battery on King Island just now. It's very similar to the previous project, 3 megawatt, 1.6 megawatt hours using the East Penn Ultra Battery for renewable integration of a totally green island. They can actually run the island without diesel unless the wind really gets extreme. And it's there. Proud of it because it's an application of the technology we funded, and it doesn't cost us a penny. This is your taxpayers' money at work. Important topic, resiliency. Look at the upper right-hand graph. That's the temperature in Washington, D.C. over the ages. Look at the lower right-hand graph. That is the number of disasters costing more than $1 billion each. There are trends there. They indicate that the situation will get worse, not better. Picture on the left shows you what might happen, and has happened in many coastal towns. The take-home message from this is, and this is in Scientific American, so it must be true, every $1 spent on protection measurements can prevent $4 in repairs after the storm. See, now, this is something that's not in the standard metric for storage, for example. Okay, but if you're using it for resilience, you can imagine that whatever you spend will bring you four times that much when you really need it. It's the old project. I mean, you know, what's the price of air? Air isn't very expensive. But, you know, if you happen to be without it, it becomes very dear. Won't go into this, but 50% of the diesel generators failed to start during the Sandy emergency. And with storage, you can have microgrids. With storage and renewables, you can have microgrids, which can run at least for mission-critical facilities indefinitely, for as long as you need it. Okay, but during emergency, it provides. During non-emergency period, you can use it. It provides demand management for the user and compensated services to the grid. Use it everywhere. Example, Vermont Public Service Department. We're very proud because I believe that the frontier for the technology is now the states. I like working with the states because, you know, federal funding always has this sort of dictate from above type thing. The states are immediately in contact with the users. You know, so that is a level that I'm very fond of. So we're working with the Vermont Public Service Department and Green Mountain Power. There was a solicitation issued by Vermont Public Service. With joint funding, they kicked in $50K, we kicked in $250K, and Green Mountain Power kicked in $3.4 million. It's good leverage. But the point is, without us, they wouldn't have started. And it's going to be in Rutland, Vermont, 2 megawatts, 3.4 megawatt hours. Integrator will be Dynapower, ancillary grid services, peak shaving, etc. And we provide tools. You know, we are not just building demonstrations. We are trying to create a storage community, a storage industry. We have a test laboratory at Sandia that handles entire systems up to 1 megawatt. There is a GS UASA, for example, at the test lab. We are active in developing, we have developed a protocol to measure and report performance of energy storage technology. This was a collaboration of about 100 members from the industry. It's available on the internet for free. We have funded the voluminous DOE EPRI Energy Storage Handbook together with EPRI and NRECA. Again, it's available on the internet for free. And that's it. DOE Energy Storage Program aggressively furthers market pull and technology push. We need both of those. We've got to meet in the middle. We do demonstrations and do research. Thank you.
Thank you to all our panelists. We have about 10 minutes for questions, and I have a couple law student volunteers walking around with mics. I see one hand here. And the questions can be to any of the panelists or all of them. Go ahead.
I think my question is for all of the panelists, and I have a question about battery toxicity and how important an issue that is. I know a lot of the batteries we're talking about today are made of toxic materials, and I know there are a lot of batteries under development that are non-toxic, and is that even a part of the conversation?
Could I also ask you to say your name and your affiliation?
I'm Pam Burkle, and an interested person.
Great, thank you.
Shall I try that one? If you were here in my first presentation, you saw that nice slide with the fireballs, you know. I don't usually show that because I'm trying to turn people onto battery, not off batteries. But, and again, in the spirit of developing an industry rather than selling batteries, you know, we need to pay great attention to safety. And so we, together with EPRI and many others, have started a safety initiative. And the safety initiative speaks to both fire and other problems and toxicity. Now, since you asked about toxicity, all batteries are toxic to some degree. Okay? You know, they have, you know, a bromine solution and then they have zinc in them. Or they have vanadium. Okay? The point is, in the electrolyte, if you have a flow battery, the amount that you actually get, I mean, if you were to touch it or possibly even ingest some of it, is relatively low, okay? You don't really want to drink it, but, you know, you deal with bromine, for example, in your swimming pool or your jacuzzi all the time. And, again, safety measures are needed. For example, you know, there is generally a volume equal to the volume in the tank provided underneath the facility, you know, a gravel pit, basically, which is shielded from the outside. So, you know, it's quite safe. Lead acid, lead is toxic, of course, but lead acid batteries are the most recycled industrial product of any product. They are about 98% recycled, and that includes the battery fluid, and it includes the lead. If they didn't recycle, they couldn't build batteries. Does it sort of answer your question halfway?
From the utility perspective, we just got done submitting our permits to the local permitting agency on our project, and we spent a significant amount of time developing a hazardous material management plan. Working with the battery manufacturers, our environmental folks, battery recyclers, to have a plan to handle the batteries, get rid of them, move them from the substation back to our operations center if needed, and also working with the local fire department to ensure that, you know, we had a plan to address a major catastrophe.
I'd like to say that for pumped storage hydro, it's storage media, which is water, is about as non-toxic as you can.
Of course, dams break occasionally.
Just to build on that theme a little bit, there, and Conrad has very good reasons to be proud here. His alma mater, Carnegie Mellon, has actually worked very closely in this area, and they actually have a technology out there that, depending on who you talk to, is pretty close to cutting, you know, actually making it out into the marketplace. It's Aquion, and it is largely an aqueous battery with made from very common materials, designed for home applications and with suitable power density and energy density. So it is top of mind. I mean, and of course, having said that, I mean, how many park a car with a full tank of gas in your car, in your house, right? I mean, you do this kind of routinely. You know, those with an EV battery, you have a lithium-ion battery in your car. So, you know, we do these kinds of things and we accept risks, but with regard to energy storage and depending on the application, it certainly is a top-of-mind issue.
Yeah, Aquion is one of my companies. Didn't show the slide because we don't have time, but they are so convinced that they are environmentally benign that they offer to eat it if necessary.
Thank you. Great question. I see another one up front.
Yes, I have one. My name is Buzz Thielman, RHT Energy Solutions. I attended a solar conference, which SMA was there, and they were talking about their inverter that actually could take a lagging power factor, make it leading, actually had that correction. I was wondering on storage, is this a power conditioning benefit that is normally worked into the proposal for the utility, or is it not?
Yeah, I would say definitely. You know, most of the inverters out there for large energy storage systems are four-quadrant inverters, and they can provide VARs. They can consume VARs at the same time they're producing real power or consuming real power.
Thank you.
I might add to that that the Smart Inverter Working Group is working on allowing having standards that allow these four-quadrant inverters. The standards prior to this were making that difficult. So it's not just a technology thing. It's also a standards issue. And the standards are changing.
Great. I see a question in the back.
Thank you. Roberta Mann from the University of Oregon School of Law. And I'm not a student. Did I do that? I'm really sorry. So I have a question that relates back to the first question. I really don't even want to use this. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So my question is about batteries as well, but not about toxicity, but rather about do you have concerns about the availability of rare earths, which, as I understand, are a very important component of certain types of batteries, particularly more advanced batteries?
Any comments from the panel?
Oh, well, lithium's a light element. Rare earths are like cerium, lanthanum, neodymium, and sorry, I did part of my doctorate dissertation. So, if you're talking semiconductor type applications, then you have more rare earth concerns, I think. But folks can correct me if I'm wrong here, but I don't know of any limitations on it.
No, vanadium is not rare at all. It's a byproduct of the steel industry. In fact, generally, when you're trying to do a cost-effective battery, you look towards the most abundant elements in the Earth crust. You know, there's a nice chart that shows you the abundance of elements, and things like zinc, bromine, iron, vanadium, chromium, they're all in that upper area where you have considerable abundance. There's nothing that includes rare earths as such.
What I would add is that my belief is that the marketplace will somewhat take care of that. I believe in yesterday's Wall Street Journal there was an article about new technology for developing lithium, for example. That's also why we believe the standards for building energy storage systems are important, because to the extent that you can have the components of an energy storage system be more modular based on an open standard, then as these battery technologies get better in advance and become more economical, whether that's because there's cheaper materials or whatever, it just makes it easier for the industry to scale and grow.
Great, thank you. Is that a question up here in the front?
Hi, my name is Bonnie Bailey. I'm with Applied Exergy. I have a question for Dr. Lee. You had talked about the energy storage system that you had set up and the fire suppression system because you have lithium-ion batteries. Can you tell me what percentage of the project cost was for the fire protection system?
Very small. I don't have the precise number, but we actually know the number. I just don't quite recall it, but it's very small compared to the entire installation. But very worthwhile.
Any other questions right now? I have one. and then we can go to Conrad. While you may be partial to your own projects, given Commissioner Savage's vivid description of the pimple, I'm wondering if this overgeneration pimple in California is, you know, to come true, what energy storage technologies or applications could help Oregon prevent a similar pimple in, say, the next 5, 10, 15 years? Anyone?
Clearly, when it comes to large volumes of energy that need to be managed, grid-scale storage facilities have an advantage there. But storage most likely will take a path of both centralized, large grid-scale resources as well as distributed, providing benefits both locally and at the regional level.
I really see the bigger hole being in the not the storage system themselves, but the control systems, and then above the control systems, systems to optimize the dispatch of all these energy storage resources. I mean, you can put them all out there, but if you don't got good technology to leverage them and really use them, they're not going to provide a whole lot of benefit for you. And that needs to be integrated with your grid management software, like your SCADA systems, your EMS, your DMS, and there's a lot of work to be done there. Mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of work.
I think Conrad had a question. I don't know if there's a mic available. Oh, you have one? Thanks.
Conrad Justus, Portland General Electric. My question has to do with really small is beautiful and modularization. I'm going to look all through your stuff that you're doing, Jason, because it sounds really cool. My question gets to resiliency because, you know, the really bad storms tend to last a week. You know, the bad ice storm, the bad, you know, Sandy. And batteries are not good choices for, you know, days. So I'm looking maybe towards Emre. Is there research being done? If you look at there's for the bean counters, there's 800 gigawatts of generation in the U.S. that produce electricity. But if you look in garages, there's 20,000 gigawatts of engines that sit idle most of the time. And if you could go to plug-in hybrid electric vehicles, you could back up the battery in the house. And so my question is there any work being done on the sort of an end game for resiliency where there's a certain amount of battery in the house that supplies, let's say, a half day, and then if the outage go beyond a half day, you just plug in the car to, you know, recharge the battery for as long as you need it. So just any
yeah. Actually, a lot of people are playing with vehicle-to-grid or vehicle-to-emergency. That's because we have more and more battery systems in cars. Well, I mean, every car has a battery system, but you know, we are now beginning to get large ones. It's a complex issue. I personally am not enamored of using electric vehicles on a regular basis to bolster the grid. Because when you do that, it's just like running your battery, and it means you lose capacity on it. So whether you are in stop-start traffic or whether you're doing stop-start for the grid, you know, it decreases your lifetime. There are also really serious issues about insurance. You know, is your car still under warranty if you use it for a different purpose and so on?
I'm not talking about
about
using the battery in the car.
Yeah, I heard you. So I don't believe in the direct grid applications. But in terms of a home backup, I think they're perfect. You know, and it's only a question of the control mechanism. But, you know, you wouldn't want to run your entire home. You would only run mission critical things, you know, etc. And you can do this from your car, or in a larger community, you can do it with batteries and renewables. And yes, you can do it for days if you restrict yourself to mission critical facilities.
Any other comments from the panel on that question?
Sure, I'll add a comment. You know, I think the other, for the kind of these long-term outages, I think individual homeowners are increasingly looking to their own, rooftop generation and those kinds of things. There was an interesting, I think it was Morgan Stanley analysis of the new Tesla Gigafactory, and in that analysis was increasingly the opportunity for homeowners to have small-scale energy storage in their home and some kind of energy generation capability, whether that's rooftop solar or fuel cells or something like that. So I see that as more likely than the car approach.
I just want to add my amen to that. Last October, I became a net metering customer and added a battery system as well. And it was emergency preparedness. That was my primary motive.
Thanks. Any additional questions from the audience? I have one in the back.
This is Shane with One Energy Renewables. With regard to the scope of services that storage can provide, not One Energy System, just how you guys are talking up there, One Energy Renewables, as far as arbitrage goes, how many of the utilities actually have the capability to provide real-time pricing signals to the operator? Is that something that we need to develop more? I'm curious.
Pricing signals are really based on scheduling windows. So scheduling windows kind of move in the northwest from the hour market down to a 15 market. Potentially in an EIM situation where we're down to a 5-minute market, those price signals can be sent to the facilities that are providing storage generation to the grid. So it's really a function of how well, how tightly, how short a period those markets operate.
And this guy really is the expert. I mean, he's just came off the trading floor not too long ago. So. But I will tell you that as part of our work down in Salem, the whole notion of a transactive energy system pushed off to the side, demonstrated with 11-12 utility nodes, was basically to actually drive to this future where you could actually see how a real system would react using the type of intelligence that a trader would see making half hour type of schedules, except now you squeeze it down to that much shorter period of time. And when you get down to that really short period of time, your brain just won't do it. I mean, you can't absorb that kind of information. You got to have a line of folks behind you to take over when you're done, but a computer can't. And so that is why on my slide there, I indicated two items in blue when I talked about the opening about the five assets. Those last two, the one in particular, are the ones that are a little bit out there, farther out in the future. And that one, by far and away, is probably the farthest out right now. But even now, it's when you start looking at the development of the energy imbalance markets, those are the time frames that are being looked at. And it's probable they'll be highly automated when you do that.
I see a question here in the middle.
Hi, Jimmy Lindsay with Renewable Northwest, and I've got a question for Wayne. Jason's presentation mentioned that for many energy storage systems, the sort of expected utility use case was made unavailable by a incomplete vendor system or sort of communication pathway. I wondered if there are any expected uses that PG had of its Salem energy storage system that really haven't been realized due to limitations of software.
That's a very good question, and at this point, I cannot answer affirmatively because we haven't actually tried all those test cases as yet. But there is a slide that I haven't shown folks here, but it's actually in the presentation. It's the very last one, but it actually shows you our control panel inside the Salem Smart Power Center, and I mean, it looks like the Apple I computer in 1975. And 35 years later, most of what it can do looks like this, right? And so at the end of the day, standards evolve, you get more miniaturization. We've already concluded that if we had been a little bit maybe a little bit more clever, that's one PLC that we didn't need. But when you evolve serial number one and the software that goes with it, and a lot of this is actually homegrown software, actually, then you sort of take it as it comes. And at this point, we haven't seen anything that would be a showstopper. I think that's part of the implication of the question. most everything we see can be done, whether it's done by a standard, which I think we'd all argue for, or a homegrown work, then that's kind of state of the art at this point.
Great. I see one question in the back, and I think that'll be our last one.
Okay. I'm Michael Kindnermeyer from the Pacific Northwest National Laboratory, and I have a question actually for the entire panel. I would consider you as the leadership, the industry leadership in energy storage nationally and particularly here in the Pacific Northwest. So as you have engaged in energy storage for the last several years, what do you think was the biggest challenge? So in other words, what kept you up at night when you thought about energy storage and how to make this sort of a successful story for your particular business? Maybe just one quick sentence.
I'll start, and that's a battery fire. That'll put you back mm-hmm. years. And I'm just being kind of straightforward about that. That's the negative consequences of that, and whenever you have a fire in any facility, it kind of puts you back. And so what you've heard, hopefully, is the safety standards and the siting and PGE's great innovative efforts, but very strong efforts. I mean, across the panel, safety is first, and protecting the public and protecting the investment. So that's. Yes, what keeps me up, probably doesn't keep me up at night, but I do worry about that. What are the setbacks that you would have to endure?
Yeah, as a professional engineer, I would agree with what he said, battery fire, and then also just integration of the components.
I'd agree. Safety is always number one. Getting the cost down is number two. If you have a project that doesn't quite pencil out the way you expected it, you get questions, you paid how much, and what did we get for it, and why didn't we do it this other way? And that's kind of hard to live down. That puts you on hold for a while.
Any additional comments?
We had three showstoppers on this project at Salem. One was administrative, the second was financial, and the third was technical. And I will tell you, out of the three, none of them kept me up at night, although the technical one almost did. But out of the three, we defeated two of them by our own resources and brain power and all the rest of that. The second one, it was actually the financial one, we just got lucky. So, I mean, you can be good, but, being lucky just helps. And 75% subsidy. That helps, too. Yeah, great, a great discount on the price. But to show you how bad it got on the technical one, which was the very last bit, and we rarely tell the story, but, we had it all parked in place. We were exercising the thing, and it just wouldn't stay on. I mean, it just would not stay on. And so... it got so bad, the project engineer and I sat down and came up with the top 10 things you can do with a grid-sized battery. you have to interject a fair amount of good humor when you do something like this, especially for serial number one. But that's the kind of thing that makes projects like these go, and it's quite funny. I'll do it for any time you like.
Thanks for the great questions, everyone. We heard some good discussion on energy storage applications. So as I was saying, we heard some great discussion on energy storage applications, seamless integration, demonstration projects, among others. And lucky for you all, those are also roundtable topics. So you can join us this afternoon to continue and contribute to the discussion. We'll take a 15-minute break, and you can sign up for roundtable topics outside. And please come back into the room for the second panel at 11. Thank you.
Yeah. I remember when we power. They built they burned down the entire facility. So at the same time they were constructing our facility. And I said, does this mean
our $25 million investment is down the drain. They did eventually go bankrupt, but not until after they constructed our facility. Battery fire is something we don't want.
Unfortunately, I think it's
I'm going to catch up. I didn't give a holiday.
I'm Nice to meet you, Jeff, and I'll follow up with you.
Thank you.
Could we start to gather, please? I know the break was too short, but if folks could start to take their seats, I'd appreciate it. Todd, come up. Where's Ken? You? We need Ken. Oh, there he is, in orange. You have your assigned seat. Take some seats, continue to talk, but started. So please help. help me out and quiet the conversations and start to take your seats? I'm not good at being a bully, so please help me get this set up. Hello, everyone. I need an angry voice. Yeah. I'm checking out name tags. I'm looking to see who's still talking, making demerits. Please come in and take your seats. We'll close the doors now. That might be the best way, so folks that want to talk can continue to do so in the hall. Thank you. Great. A few obvious announcements, just to say it again. All these presentations will be available on our website. All of their folder contents are already available on the website, but all of these presentations will be as well. And if you have any questions about that, you can contact me or Eric. His cards are in the hallway. But we'll be publishing those things and also resources. Some of the papers that, for example, Dr. Zhuk put up, we'll be publishing all of that on our website so that you have a resource to follow up on the storage workshop. Also, I want to encourage you to review the roundtable overviews that are in your folders, because right after this, we'll be asking you to commit and actually sign up for a roundtable so that we have a sense of how much space to dedicate to each one. So please do look at those roundtable overviews. Finally, I've been asked to make a note about an event tomorrow in Seattle. There'll be an event called the Progress and Promise in U.S. Grid Energy Storage, including Washington State. It'll be in Seattle. And Dr. Zhuk will be also giving a keynote address there, although in greater depth. Rick Locke from Washington Department of Commerce will describe Washington State's Clean Energy Fund, under which a number of megawatt-scale energy storage products will be awarded soon. Russ, are you standing? So if you have any questions or you're interested in the Seattle conference, please talk to Russ. He'll be there, and it sounds like it's going to be a great event, but focused on Washington, back to back. So this panel is a very different panel than the last panel. The last panel was all about projects. It was about wires. It was about batteries. This panel is about value streams, and that's because we think it's really important to talk about not technologies and how we use certain technologies, but we want to start talking about the benefits of energy storage and where we use them and how we capture those values, either monetarily or otherwise, so that we can start to think about use cases, applications, and make priorities in Oregon. So we're going to kick off the panel with FERC. Christina Hayes here. She's going to talk about some moves that FERC has made in the last year to open up markets, really important work. Then we're going to move on to the California PUC. Alicia Charles is here, and she's going to talk about how they built the mandate, not necessarily all about the targets, but what we need to know is how they constructed it in the first place. So that's what Mel's going to speak to. Then we have actually developer perspective. We have AES here, Praveen Kathpal, who's going to speak more about their perspective on markets and utility procurement and strategies for that in the Northwest. We have Ken Dragoon from ICFIS, who's going to talk about his recent paper and valuation models. And then finally, we're going to round it out with Todd Alinsky-Paul from Clean Energy States Alliance. And he's going to talk more about resiliency, because obviously our partners in the Northeast are facing serious issues when it comes to system resiliency. And they're deploying energy storage as a tool. And I want to hear more about that, because that could be very important for Oregon as well. So with that, I'm going to ask Christina to come and join us.
Okay. Thank you. My name is Christina Hayes. I'm from the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, but long ago I graduated from U of O Law School, so thank you very much for having me back. I can actually directly trace my career to volunteering at a conference just like this, my first year of law school. So if anybody has any questions either today or after today, feel free to follow up. I will start by saying the title of, how does this work? Launched.
Button down here. It's the easy quick button.
The easy button.
Yeah.
Okay. So I'll start by saying that the title FERC storage rules is a total misnomer. Actually, I'll start with a disclaimer. Any views expressed here are my own and do not necessarily represent the views of FERC or the United States government. But FERC is resource neutral. FERC's obligations are to ensuring that rates are just and reasonable and not unduly discriminatory. FERC reviews its rules to ensure that there are no regulatory barriers to new technologies. We look at how the whole grid works, how the transmission system works. And so what we're going to talk about today are ancillary services to ensure the transmission system works better and how storage can play a role. FERC tries to make sure that there's a level playing field to allow new technologies such as demand response, variable energy resources such as solar and wind, and storage to participate in the markets. So the most relevant rulemakings that affect storage, particularly in bilateral markets such as those in the Pacific Northwest, include Order 784, which actually is dealing with third-party ancillary services. It does deal with accounting rules for storage. And also Order 792, which deals with small generator interconnection procedures. But again, that was initiated by a petition by solar interests. So it deals with a number of different generation to connect to the grid. Before 784 was issued in the last year, FERC ensures that rates are just and reasonable by looking at negotiated rates and granting applications for market-based rate authority. So if you want to sell services or sell energy at negotiated rates, you have to come in, you have to define the product that you want to sell, you have to define the geographic market that you want to sell in, and you have to show that you cannot exert market power. Generally, that's by showing that you have a less than 20% market share. So if you are an entity that wants to sell ancillary services into the grid, you have to come in and show that you cannot exert market power in the ancillary services market. The problem is we don't have a lot of data showing how ancillary services are sold in bilateral markets. It is easier to collect data on energy sales, and so easier to show a lack of market power as to energy and capacity. And that was the issue that FERC was looking at. So in bilateral markets, they have what they call the Avista restrictions, which is that essentially you had to sell ancillary services at cost to public utility transmission providers. This raised several issues. For one, because these costs could be passed through, there was not a real incentive to hold ancillary service costs down on the one hand. On the other hand, it wasn't clear that the market signal was there to incentivize more ancillary services to be provided into the market, and there was concern that there, especially as variable energy resources were coming into the market, that there were sufficient ancillary services to compensate. So, in Order 784, the Commission looked at whether or not the market screens for energy and capacity essentially could be used as a proxy for ancillary services, in particular for energy and generator imbalance services, which have to be settled within an hour. So the Commission found in the final rule that as long as you can show that you could pass the market power screens for energy and capacity, you can also show that you pass them for energy and generator imbalance if you're selling into a BAA with intra-hour scheduling. And that becomes important later. Based on additional questions asked in the Notice of Proposed Rulemaking, the Commission also found that the same screen can be shown that you don't have market power for operating reserve spinning reserves and supplemental services But in those cases, you also have to show how the scheduling in that BAA supports your services. For instance, supplemental operating reserves is for a short period of time. So for instance, 15-minute scheduling could be used to support that service. However, spinning reserves are more of an immediate requirement, and so you have to show how the BAA can schedule on that more immediate time frame. The commission found, however, that the screens were not valid proxies for reactive supply and voltage control services or for regulation and frequency response services. The final rule found that there are more stringent technical and geographic considerations associated with these services that suggest they are not simple combinations of basic energy and capacity. And so the commission decided to open a new proceeding to deal with those questions with a technical conference to be held on April 22nd, and I'll talk more about that here in a minute. Some of the questions that the commission is going to take a look at regarding reactive supply and voltage control and regulation frequency response include the ease and cost effectiveness of relevant equipment upgrades, the need for and availability of appropriate special transmission arrangements such as dynamic scheduling or pseudo-tie arrangements, and other technical requirements for provision of these ancillary services. Rehearing on Order 784 was just issued a couple of weeks ago, so this conference is very timely again. I'm sure you planned it that way, Rebecca. Questions that were asked specific to issues related to the Pacific Northwest were whether or not intra-hour scheduling meant 15 minutes as required in the VERS rule, so another rule that the commission's been working on related to variable energy resource services requires 15-minute scheduling really through most of the country, but left some wiggle room for certain areas that we're working on, say an energy imbalance market or other market tools, trying to provide flexibility for all regions in the country. So I understand that in some regions there's 30-minute scheduling. As talked about earlier, energy and generator imbalance services can be sold to any BAA with any kind of intra-hour scheduling, not just the 15-minute, but also 30-minute. But again, there's that extra hook for operating reserves, supplemental and spinning, where you have to show how the scheduling in that BAA supports that short period of time or immediate deployment. So that might be a higher hurdle in an area with 30-minute scheduling, not to prejudge anything, of course. There was also the question as to whether or not the Avista restrictions that ancillary services must be sold at cost-based rates that are in an open access transmission tariff applies to public utility transmission providers, but those restrictions do not apply to sales to non-public utility transmission providers. So it doesn't apply if you're selling to BPA, for instance. The commission's been, you know, consistent in acknowledging that distinction throughout the rulemaking process. So coming up, there is the technical conference on April 22nd. This is in a brand new docket. So if you are interested in providing comments, this conference will be webcast. It will not be transcribed. There is always, of course, a call for comments after the conference is held. So I urge you to take note of the docket number if you're interested in providing comments. And notice has been issued, a 10-page notice with all kinds of questions specific to each of these ancillary services has been issued. What I thought was most interesting is that frequency response frequently falls under regulation in Schedule 3 for regulation purposes. However, frequency response seems to be enjoying kind of its moment in the sun. Last July, two notices of proposed rulemaking were issued as to frequency response, one related to the NERC standard that was recently approved, I think just in January or February, but then also an additional notice that the commission issued with questions about the market implications for the new NERC standard, and that's in AD 13-8. Comments were submitted in October. I know, for instance, BPA submitted comments about market implications for the NERC standard as to operation of the COI, the California-Oregon intertie, but that docket is still open. So that is what the commission is looking forward to coming up, and I will turn it over to my colleague from California.
Christina. Christina just took us through an incredible roller coaster of a lot of activity at FERC, so I'll expect a lot of questions from you guys about some of the things she raised. Let me get you up here. Yeah. So next we have Mel Charles from the California PUC.
Hi, everyone. Can you hear me? Cool. Unlike you, I'm sorry, Christina, this is my first time in Oregon and in Portland, and it's a lovely city, lovely people, so, and great weather yesterday, so thank you. So I am here to talk about California's energy storage mandate. I am Commissioner Carla Peterman's advisor, and we were the assigned office for the storage proceeding, and so we were the ones who helped develop the mandate over the past year. I will talk through what we did, but I can tell you there's been several years of work that went into developing this mandate. So briefly, I will talk about the California Public Utility Commission and what we do. Our mission is to serve the public interest by providing safe and reliable utility service at reasonable rates. And we do pride ourselves in not only regulating utility services, but stimulating innovation and markets where possible in communications, energy, transportation, and water. In terms of our energy oversight, there's a lot of emphasis on energy at the CPUC. We regulate the investor-owned utilities and gas utilities. That includes Pacific Gas and Electric Company, Southern California Edison Company, Southern California Gas Company, and San Diego Gas and Electric Company, which serve over two-thirds of the total electricity demand in California and over three-quarters of the gas demand. We play a key role as a national and international leader on a number of energy-related initiatives, which include energy efficiency, renewable energy, and now energy storage. Our work includes developing and administering these policies and programs to serve the public interest and ensure compliance with legislative and regulatory mandates. Okay, moving forward. Ooh. Hello. Let me. Strange. The mouse doesn't seem to be working. Hello.
There's no other tools. There.
Yeah.
There we go.
Okay. That's it.
Okay.
Awesome. So now, the energy storage mandate. It began with Assembly Bill 2514, which was authored by Nancy Skinner in 2010, and it directed the CPUC to open a proceeding to adopt procurement targets, if appropriate, for each load-serving entity for a viable and cost-effective energy storage. It also ordered the CPUC to reevaluate this determination every 3 years through an evaluation process. And future IOUs, investor-owned utilities, renewable portfolio standard plans must comply with the storage decision. The rulemaking. It began in 2010. It established a framework of storage applications and use cases. There were 21 end uses and 7 use cases, distinct types of storage that were considered from a policy perspective. It identified regulatory barriers to storage deployment, which include a lack of a regulatory framework, a lack of a cohesive cost recovery mechanism, a lack of clearly defined interconnection rules for storage. And those are just a few of the barriers that were identified. The rulemaking also ordered 2 cost-effective analyses by EPRI and DMV KEMA, which are preliminary cost-effectiveness stories related to storage, which also looked at their uses and their use cases and whether or not they were cost-effective. And this is a key piece. The last bullet is this proceeding has relied upon an ongoing collaboration with stakeholders. So that includes the utilities, it includes the storage industry, it includes
ORA is our Office of Ratepayer Advocates and other ratepayer advocates, other NGOs. It also includes collaboration with our California Energy Commission and the California Independent System Operator. So this has been a very collaborative, very public process where we've depended on feedback from stakeholders. In terms of the storage mandate and the decision, it was approved last October, and it orders 1.3 gigawatts of storage by 2020 through four biennial solicitations beginning this year. PG&E and Edison have just over 500 megawatts they must procure by 2020, and SDG&E, which is a much smaller service territory, is required to procure 165 megawatts. And they are divided into three grid domains, which I'll talk about a little bit later. The non-utility load serving entities, which include our direct access providers, and it also includes our community choice aggregators, are also ordered to procure 1% of their peak load by 2020. In terms of the target, it is divided into three grid domains, as I mentioned. In terms of the function, it includes, at the transmission, it includes generation and market function, includes transmission reliability, which is under FERC jurisdiction. In terms of distribution connected storage, that includes distribution reliability, again, generation market functions, and dual use functions. And then we also have customer-sided and behind-the-meter storage targets, which include bill management, permanent load shifting, and EV charging. Just a breakdown of the storage targets, I'm not going to go into major detail, but you can see it's not only broken down by grid domain, it's also broken down by targets for each procurement period and for each service territory. So 2 seconds to look at this chart to give you a sense of what the targets we are ordering the utilities to procure. So. Because this is a nascent industry and a lot is unknown for us, a key piece of this decision and this mandate is flexibility. We don't know how much is going to be procured now. It has to be cost-effective energy storage. We don't know how much will be cost-effective now versus later. And so there is flexibility in this mandate, including after solicitation, a utility may request deferment of up to 80% of the targets. If they can show an unreasonable cost burden or a lack of viable projects. And then deferments are then added back into the next solicitation. And basically you can defer through 2020, but the utilities are ordered to procure the total by 2020. Some other flexibility in the mandate includes over-procurement in 1 year can be applied to the subsequent solicitation. So you can bank megawatts if you over-procure. The utilities can shift up to 80% of the targets between transmission and distribution grid domain. And again, it's just acknowledging we don't know where the bids will be coming from, where the utility, utility will have uses. So we allow, a lot of flexibility in terms of shifting back and forth between grid domains. And then one non-flexible piece is that we don't allow any portion of the procurement targets to be traded among the utilities. In terms of project eligibility, the mandate has high-level guiding principles, and that includes grid optimization, storage to support integration of renewable energy, and the reduction of GHG emissions. So these projects must address at least one or more of these policy goals. Procurement from other proceedings or programs can be counted. And what that means is that we do have existing proceedings that procure storage. Storage has been procured in years prior, and we do allow those to count towards the targets. Pump storage over 50 megawatts is not eligible simply because of the sheer size of large-scale pump storage would dwarf the targets. And to count against the targets, the projects must be installed and operational after 2020 and in operation no later than December 31, 2024. So they'll be procured by 2020, but they can't, but they must be installed by 2024. And I'm sorry, installed and operational before 2010. So past projects after 2010 can count towards the target. Additional directives, the utilities have been ordered to file applications in 2014. We just got the applications, so we're looking and reviewing those right now. The first competitive solicitation will happen in December 2014, pending commission approval of the applications. The proposed types of storage will be procured and will include quantities and operational requirements. The application includes procurement details and includes PPA details. And it also includes bid evaluation protocols, which includes cost effectiveness protocols. The utility-owned storage is limited to 50% of cumulative targets across all grid domains. Oh, sorry, across all grid domains. I have one more minute, so I'm going to speak very quickly, which means that basically utilities can own 50% of the megawatts across transmission, distribution, and customer side. And after 3 years, the CPC staff will be doing a comprehensive evaluation of the program, and the program will be modified as needed. And where we are now, like I said, the applications have come in. We're looking at the applications, and they will be considered. There'll be additional stakeholder comment that will be considered as we look at these applications and prepare to approve them. Once they're approved, the RFO will be issued in December 2014. And the last thing I will say is that we have just begun the implementation process, and so there's many, many details in terms of value streams, in terms of use cases, all of it that need to be worked out and our interactions with the CAISO and their various markets. But right now, the amount of interest and what we have seen, it's looking very promising. So I'm hoping to report back another time with some more information for you guys.
Great. There's so much going on in California right now as well. Next up, we have a Praveen Kathpal from AES. Just started here, provided it works.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. I'm Praveen from AES. And thanks for having me here. Thanks for having all of us here. For those of you unfamiliar, AES is a global power company. We have generation and utilities in 21 countries, but I'm not going to spend much time on that. And we've been deploying energy storage, battery-based energy storage resources that are grid-connected for the past 6 years. So what you see on the left there, that was our serial number one. And we've since brought on projects at a kind of steady pace, increasing size. And some of those have won awards. Those are the circles you see there. One's the Excellence in Renewable Energy Award. The other one's the Edison Award from EEI. So in doing this, we just recently hit a milestone, I believe in January, of providing over 1.5 million megawatt hours of commercial service from our various commercial scale battery facilities, and we've done that with a very strong safety record as well. Of course, being in generation utilities, safety is our top priority and the company's number one value. Here's some close-ups of the pictures, close-up pictures of the projects that I mentioned. This is our most recent one in Ohio. This is our largest one in West Virginia. And this one in West Virginia, Laurel Mountain, it provides frequency regulation in the PJM market. And what you see in that larger chart is its performance over a 24-hour period. And you can see that it's a very noisy signal. So what you can see there is that it's very fast ramping. It has a very wide, flexible range, so that's plus and minus 32 megawatts, and that it's available to provide this service in all hours. And the projects I didn't show you pictures of are the ones that we have in Latin America, and those are very similar physically, but they have a different control scheme where they're providing a contingency reserve, so they're also available 24 hours, and they're also providing some primary frequency response. So the culmination of our deployments we recently announced is as a product launch is Advancion, which is a complete modular, scalable, fully integrated solution from the physical architecture to the inside the box controls, the outside the box to the SCADA, all the way to an iPad interface for the operators. So that's what we just unveiled a couple weeks ago at an EEI event in DC. So what does all this do? What I was showing you, that dispatch chart of Laurel Mountain, I talked about how it's available in all hours, it has a wide flexible range, it's very fast ramping. And when you compare that to some of the conventional resources that are being added for flexibility purposes, those are distinct advantages. Particularly, we heard Commissioner Savage this morning mention the E3 report that looked at very high renewable penetration scenarios. And that's where you see that the load side, the load half of the dispatchable range, has value. So it has value in the net load trough as well as the net load peak. So you're actually getting more megawatts. And I think this is key to any cost effectiveness evaluation of storage, is that it actually has more megawatts for the things that that our resource procurement decisions are motivated by. So I'm sure some of you are wondering, is this guy really going to talk about ancillary services the whole time? And the answer is no. We're moving beyond that. So the U.S., this is the latest from EIA, and I understand all the caveats that come with the EIA projections, but I think it is representative that there's a set of assumptions that reasonable people can make today that show that we have a 90 gigawatt capacity need in this country, and 40 of those are in the next 15 years. So we're either in the planning horizon for those, or we're about to be by the time we get our act together on storage. Everyone says any planning result that says you're gonna build gigawatts and gigawatts of CTs is just a placeholder, but what's it a placeholder for? And we think a lot of that opportunity is gonna be addressed by storage. So how do you address that need? And this is bringing it into the region. This is the midterm assessment from the council on the sixth plan, and it talks about there's going to be a need for capacity and flexibility. And anyone who hasn't looked yet, the development of the seventh plan is underway, and you can go to the council site, and they have really good primers on what is capacity, what is flexibility, and I highly recommend those to anyone. So this brings up, how do these needs get met? They get met through some sort of planning exercise, typically in the region, integrated resource planning, and then some type of procurement activity. And ideally, there would be some sort of feedback loop. And of course, those activities don't occur in a vacuum. There's this entire stakeholder environment between the industry, different government entities, and various outside stakeholders who participate. And I was fortunate to meet a lot of the people involved in that in the region, and realize that it's a very, very robust stakeholder environment. And then, of course, all of this is with our base criteria of being reliable, affordable, and sustainable. So we don't have to go through each of these, but this is to show you that in each of those segments of the industry and the government and other stakeholders, there's a lot of activity oriented towards storage. And I think this is a great example that the Oregon Department of Energy and the Oregon Public Utility Commission could convene this workshop. And obviously there's a lot of other stuff going on, both on the stakeholder side, the government side, and the industry side. Also on the government side, because Jay Ward from Senator Wyden's office was here early, I said I would put in a plug that Senator Wyden has been resiliently introducing in each Congress the storage investment tax credit bill. So that's still out there. So one thing we've observed is that there's limited feedback going on from the planning and procurement processes to inform the subsequent cycles. And I have a couple examples from the region, but you know, I'm not picking on anyone. This is happening all over the country, and we're fortunate to have Emery from DOE, Dan Borneo from Sandia, if you don't know him, Todd over here, who interact with commissions and utilities all over the country about these regulatory issues. And I hope we can spur more of that type of feedback. But basically, this is an example where a commission said, look at storage in your IRP, and then there was an RFP in which multiple battery bids were received. And then in the next IRP, storage wasn't modeled, and the commission wasn't too happy with that. And then another example where there was an IRP, there was an RFP, and a final report from that said that a battery bid was economically competitive, and then the immediate following IRP excluded battery energy storage because it wasn't technologically or economically viable. This is happening all over the country. So I think the question is, how do we get out of this? Because that rationale isn't the case. And I think what some of Mel's colleagues have presented is where Southern California Edison had storage included as a portion of their procurement. We've been told that they received over 1,000 offers total, and over 500 of those offers included storage. So the market is ready. But how do we access that? What can we do? And I think all the stakeholders that I talked about bear responsibility in this, in finding out, as Ruchi said, what is the path forward to deployment. And there are different things that you can do. I think, first of all, we've seen voluntarily utilities across the country, the Long Island Power Authority, a couple of them in California, Imperial Irrigation District, SCAPA over in Hawaii, on Kauai, all voluntarily put out storage procurements. The largest of those is 650 megawatts because they see the value and they see the market developing. Obviously, their policy helps. One example is a statement like this in the governor's action plan. But there are other approaches. The first example I provided of that feedback loop was the ask nicely approach, right, where the commission says, please put this in your IRP, and then they asked a little less nicely the next time. Obviously, what California's done is taken a bit firmer hand, and this is actually without the legislation. The commission asked a utility, actually two utilities now, as they were preparing procurements, to have a portion of it be storage. The real heavy hand is the legislative solution, which may not be appropriate for everyone, but it's certainly gotten the market going in California. Finally, the last thing you can do, and I know I'm out of time, is comprehensively evaluate the benefits, whether that's in the planning exercise or procurement. I think Joe from EDF said it pretty well this morning on his valuation slide, particularly about the portfolio effect. And there are a number of studies like this. NREL, PNNL, Sandia have all done these great studies related to this. And in your folder, you'll see this report, and you can talk to Emery about this later. There are specific activities that DOE identified. And the way I read those is DOE, I'm just putting you on the spot, Emery, is ready to fund more of these benefits studies, and not just specific deployments, but utility-wide, system-wide, region-wide, similar to the NREL report that I referenced. And you guys can take a look at that in the slides once they're posted. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Harvey, and I'm sure Emery doesn't mind being put on the spot. He's got a lot to say, a lot to share. I really appreciate your comments, and I think that'll definitely be subject matter that we take up in the roundtables for those of you that are thinking about what's next. Next we have Ken Dragoon, Microfis, here to talk about the report that's final.
Report.
Yeah. Great. You go, Ken.
All right. Thank you. Yes, I work for Ecofis. Thanks to Lee Hall for mentioning the work that we did on demand management. We're very proud of that. Ecofis is a sustainable energy consulting company. Our headquarters is in the Netherlands, actually, but we have an office here in Oregon, Corvallis. The paper does actually exist. I think a lot of people who've been involved in it are wondering, but we had hoped to announce that it's available today. Looks like next week it will be available. And if you want a copy, just send me an email or give me your card. We were hired by EDF Renewable Energy to write a white paper that gathers together the information that's out there now. We didn't create anything new, but there's an awful lot of information out there, and it takes, if you're serious about wanting to understand the state of storage, it's a pretty big investment of time to figure that out. And we wanted to summarize it in a way that made it more accessible for folks who aren't necessarily experts in the field. So it's written at a fairly high level, hopefully very understandable. We had a voluntary advisory panel from folks across the region, the West Coast, all the way to Hawaii, spanned a range of expertise that was very much appreciated, and they had input. I won't say that it was peer-reviewed, but they had input, and we rejected very little of what anyone said, and interestingly, didn't have a lot of contrary information. So I'll steal my own thunder here. The conclusions of the report really, in many ways, not earth-shattering, but again, pulling together, you know, what sort of is out there in the literature as consensus. Energy storage is a lot of things. It's a kind of a staggering amount of different kinds of technologies that do different things for different purposes. Some of them have been around for over 100 years and are pretty well developed, and even in some of that, there's improvements in the way it interacts with the grid and the dynamic ability, for example, of pump storage to react with variable speed generators and pumps. There are real complexities in calculating the value of energy storage. There are multiple value streams, and it gets complicated. And I saw at least in one IRP where they said, we just don't have the tools to calculate this at the moment. I think that was a very good and honest appraisal of where they are. We'll talk about each of these things in a little bit more detail in a minute. Energy storage deserves to be evaluated on the same basis as other resources and utility resource plans. I think that seems kind of obvious, but they're often not. They're often overlooked, partly because there's sort of a sticker shock, oh, it costs, you know, X thousand dollars a kilowatt to install this thing, and I can get a combustion turbine for a fraction of that, and so, you know, we don't have to look at that. But the situation is more complicated than that, and it deserves more consideration. There are challenges to energy storage development that suggest continued policy intervention is needed. I think, you know, growing up in this society, we think of the free market as the answer to everything. So I think there's a legitimate question, and certainly a political question, you know, do we really need policy intervention here or not? And if we are, you know, what is the basis for that? And as was mentioned before, standardized integration with utility system energy management systems that already exist is kind of lagging. Standardization of the product. Energy storage is sort of multi-dimensional. Talk about that in a second as well. So standardization is a recognized issue. This is just a sort of a categorization of storage technologies by kind of the basic storage medium or physical property. mechanical, which includes pump storage, flywheel, and compressed air. There's electric or electromagnetic and capacitors and superconducting magnets. There's thermal energy storage and molten salts at thermal solar plants, chillers, which I just sort of added. Talk about that at the end of my last slide. Chemical storage, which I thought was very interesting, including using electricity to make hydrogen or methane and storing energy that way for later release. Electrochemical includes batteries of various kinds, where, as we've heard earlier, there is a lot of activity today. So just another word or two about modeling and valuation. It is a complex problem because there are multiple dimensions of attributes to energy storage. There's the you can talk about the cost on an installed kilowatt basis, but there it also stores kilowatt hours. And so there's a cost per kilowatt hour and a cost per kilowatt. You know, how do you trade those off? So there's sort of two dimensions that we didn't have when we were looking at other straight resources. There are life cycle limitations. Some have more, some have less. And then there's energy efficiency, the toxicity, and you know, there are a lot of different things that make this a more complicated resource than straight generators. There are two basic valuation approaches. One is to look back at historical market prices. I should say, you know, the traditional approach was to look at the low prices at night and the high prices during the day, and if you could make a return on that sufficient to pay for the energy you purchased and the capital costs, then you had a project, and projects were accepted on that basis. You could show that they were economic. We mostly don't have that today. Of course, we also don't have a market that would really sustain peakers either, and so we talk about capacity markets. So it's not just unique to storage, but anyway, looking at historical market prices for this sort of energy arbitrage I talked about, but more and more talking about ancillary services and the value there. And one of the challenges, of course, is there aren't ancillary service markets in every place or for every ancillary service, for that matter. Economic dispatch models, as a longtime planner, I'm familiar with those. That's great for things that happen on an hourly basis, sub-hourly, which a lot of the ancillary services are based on. Ancillary service values are based on, most models don't go there. And there are some models now that do go there. Not everybody has them. The data may not be available to support sub-hourly analyses. So these both approaches have challenges. It's not just complex. The historical market prices, for example, if you were to, you know, you sort of assume you can get that price, but that's sort of the marginal price at that time. Once you enter the market, the market would be depressed. You don't necessarily know how much. So then there's a whole other round of, you know, can we figure out if I entered that market, how much would that depress the market? I talked a little bit about the dispatch models already and their challenges. It's important because we do have some studies that have been done on a sub-hourly basis with the dispatch models, and also some of the more sophisticated historical market price studies that show that the value of ancillary services from energy storage may equal or exceed the value of the diurnal movement of energy. So it's kind of a big deal, and merits taking a look at. Another issue is there are a lot of places where there's a niche need, and we heard about that, where you may be at the far end of a transmission line or you've got some congestion and putting in a new substation, big transformer, or having to put in a new power line, where you can stick in an energy storage project that won't have local emissions. I mean, you could put a gas plant there, maybe, but it might be in the middle of a city or some other place. So there are important niches, and I think that's where a lot of folks are finding value, where islanded systems or other congested areas. So basically, energy storage needs to find its way into resource planning activities more than it has traditionally been. We focused on peak hour generation, not so much in Northwest, where we're mostly about energy because of the hydro, but more and more talking about peak generation. And there's a new realization that maybe this sort of notion of flexibility, ramping capability is also important, and that's another place where we need to be thinking about storage. We haven't quite totally defined what flexibility means and how much we need and how much we have. That's a special complexity. There's an interaction also with how we run the grid and where we get the flexibility. Flexibility does not have to come from just resources or even just storage. As Lee pointed out, there are other competing ways of providing flexibility or reducing the need for flexibility by either operating the variable units more or demand management. And energy storage is one of the things that needs to be considered among others. Policies are needed, we decided, or it appears at least to us that policies are needed to help with some of the technical market and risk barriers that energy storage faces. One of the issues that came up is if the market for flexibility, so our ancillary services of one sort or another, may not be very deep. So you enter that market and all of a sudden the value collapses. And this was something that some folks were interested in. We don't necessarily know how deep that is and how deep the market is. And that's a big risk factor. So if we may identify that we need this flexibility and for system reliability, and it's got to come. But if you rely on the markets, you know, somebody's got to take a risk that they may not be able to recoup their capital investment. That needs to be addressed. The innovation is really staggering. Probably this report that will come out next week will be old in just a few months in many ways because things are changing so fast. There are numbers in the report that come from, of course, other sources for the costs and capabilities of the different technologies, but you know, I really would de-emphasize that because they're changing so fast. It's really, really exciting, and policies are helping to motivate that, and that's a hugely important role. We heard about FERC. I'm not the expert, and there are other state policies that are coming online that are being helpful. And there are caveats, of course, with policies, because if they're too targeted to one technology, or you know, you may be freezing out other opportunities that could be of lower cost. So this policy thing, you know, we can see that it's necessary. We're not really advocating for a particular policy. I think it's really interesting but complex and fraught with some danger too. Integrating with utility operations, this multidimensionality is part of the problem. So you say you have 10 megawatt hours of storage. Well, what does that mean? If you used all 10 megawatt hours, does that mean you have zero next time you go to try it because you've tapped it out, or you have 9 next time you go for it? There aren't really standards for this stuff yet, and that was sort of pointed out. But also the communications and control isn't standardized, and there's a big push for standardization, but there's also some pushback on that because, you know, maybe the utility wants to be in complete control, but they may be in control of something on the user's side of the meter, and the end user may have other needs, or the ISO might have a different need than the local utility that's different than the
owner of the device that may be, standardization is not a slam dunk. And we recognize that it's needed and it's important, but it is a piece of the complexity. So just some things that I found along the way that I thought were really interesting. There's a common notion that, if you add a variable resource like wind, for every megawatt of wind, you need a megawatt of combustion turbine. And that flexibility from combustion turbines is needed to deal with the variable generators. But we're seeing, especially my colleagues in Europe, when the wind comes up, what goes offline? It's all those wonderful flexible resources you thought you had. And when the wind is blowing hardest is maybe when you have the least amount of the flexible resources. And storage isn't like that because you get the flexibility even when all other generating resources are offline because they have flexibility in the storage mode. It's very interesting and not really, it seems to me, thought about a whole bunch. I mentioned the other alternatives and Lee Hall did a good job of that. I think that's really interesting. The Western Wind and Solar Integration Study found a fairly modest need, just a few thousand megawatts, I think, for the WEC of flexibility type resources. But they assumed a whole bunch of aggregation. And if there was less aggregation, the need for flexible resources might be two or three or four times that amount. And if there's more, it's a little bit of a moving target on the flexibility side. Again, the question of how deep is that market. Another interesting thing I found is something called gas turbine inlet cooling. It's something that's done fairly routinely. It's commercially available. The idea is that combustion turbines have higher output and actually a better heat rate, more efficient, when the air that's going into them is cooler. Typically, this is done with evaporative cooling using water sprayed in the goes through basically a cooling tower before the air goes to the inlet of the combustion turbine. But you can actually actively cool that air using mechanical chillers. And the most efficient way to do that is to run those chillers at night and store the usually cold water in a tank that gets trotted out during the day to help cool. This is especially effective and used in warmer climates, of course. But the round-trip efficiency of that can be very high. And the last point here that I want to make is I had no idea how far advanced some technologies are. There's a 6-megawatt plant that started production in Germany last year that produces methane. Audi, the car maker, owns that plant, and they actually use the gas to run a car. They have a gas-powered car, and they are marketing this. The electricity is sourced from renewable energies. They have contract with some wind projects or something. But this opens the door to really longer-term storage and using the current infrastructure of gas storage, because natural gas, of course, is mostly methane. You can use existing gas turbines. You can use the existing storage facilities, store energy for quite a long time as methane, semi-natural gas. And which brings up the last point that I'd like to make is we have tended to think of these variable energy resources as a big challenge for when they're not on. What do we do when they're not on? We have to run a bunch of resources. We have to have something because they're not sort of there all the time. But I think we need to focus a little bit more on the issues that were raised earlier in the other panels about the opportunity of the generation when it does exist in excess. So this is sort of the oversupply question, the pimple, but that's, I think we need to start looking at that more of an opportunity as a big problem. So that's my talk. Thank you.
Next, we have Todd Alinsky-Paul from Clean Energy States Alliance here to talk about resiliency efforts in the Northeast. Let me set it up.
Okay. Thank you very much. I realize we were running a little late, and I'm going to try to make this fast. I gave a similar talk last week in New Mexico, and it took half an hour, but we're not going to do that here. So Todd Olinsky, Paul from Clean Energy States Alliance, just to orient you, we are a small nonprofit located in Vermont. We work with state energy offices across the country, helping them with clean energy programs and increasingly with energy storage, which we do under a contract with Sandia National Laboratories funded by DOE. So I'd like to thank Dan Borneo and Dr. Zhuk here for supporting us in that. Mainly what I'm going to talk to you about is some of the efforts that are underway right now in the northeastern states, primarily as a response to Hurricane Sandy. Those states are putting immense resources right now into energy storage and microgrids efforts. But before I get to those specific efforts, I'm going to talk for a moment about what we're seeing with states across the country. There are two main drivers for energy storage from the state's perspective. First, integration of renewables. We've heard a bit about that. And secondly, resilient power solutions. These roughly, not exactly, translate into different scale technologies. Utility scale for renewables integration, primarily, and facility, campus, or microgrid scale for resilient power solutions, primarily. And I'm going to focus more on the second in this talk. I wanted to show this slide because it illustrates a couple of things. This is data that was gathered in New Jersey in a survey following Hurricane Sandy. They surveyed 640 critical facilities, and if you look at the upper chart, you'll see that that includes things like hospitals, transportation facilities, energy generation, prisons, stormwater, all sorts of things that you want to have online and operating even when the grid is not. So these are things that are either disastrous if they cannot continue to operate under disaster conditions if the grid goes down, or facilities that provide critical services to help the grid get back up and help people survive an outage. They found that, and by the way, the office building category, which is the largest one, tends to be mostly municipally owned facilities that are critical for those municipal disaster plans being executed. They found that over 50% of these critical facilities were out of power for a week, and more than 25% were out of power for 2 weeks after Sandy. Okay, so if you imagine that half of your hospitals, water treatment plants, schools which serve as places of refuge for the population, prisons, et cetera, are not able to function because they have no electricity for a week or more, you get a sense of what these communities were facing after Sandy and other storms. It wasn't the only one, it was just the most recent and talked about one. Okay, so traditionally hospitals and others of these critical facilities have relied on backup generators, primarily diesel. There's a few problems with that. Obviously diesel is polluting. More importantly, it represents a sunk cost that sits unused more than 99% of the time. When the grid is up and functioning, your diesel is just sitting there. And as a result, when they are needed, they often fail. They're rather known for this because they're not being run on a regular basis, and therefore you don't know that there are problems that aren't being addressed because they're not being run. Also, they're reliant on fuel, and obviously deliveries of fuel are difficult when you have a natural disaster. Resilient power on site is a different paradigm. It runs 24/7. When the grid goes down, ideally, it islands and continues to provide power to your critical load. And you cannot do this with intermittent renewables alone. We had a lot of people in the Northeast that were very surprised when their PV did not continue to function because the grid went down. There's good reasons for that. And I'm not going to go into them, but you really do need to pair the renewables with storage and other technologies to enable it to island when the grid is down. Okay, I'm going to run through some of these very quickly. I'm going to start with Connecticut, because Connecticut has now a year of experience in their microgrids grant and loan pilot program, which is $45 million over 3 years grant program. They've already run through one round, $15 million. Actually, it was closer to 18. They found a few million lying around somewhere that they added to it. That's Connecticut. They found, and these are some lessons learned from their first round. This was specifically for critical facilities and microgrids. Few lessons learned. Municipalities did not have enough time to put together a reasonable proposal. Municipal officials are very good at many things, but they're not typically in the power business or the microgrid business, and they needed some time to partner with folks that are in those businesses to put together proposals. They needed help with financing. They needed, I'm going to skip through some of these, legislative changes were needed, and the state knew this ahead of time and took care of this, to allow the sale of electricity across public right-of-ways to avoid violating utility franchises. And the scoring of the proposals, the weighting of the proposals by the state was not, they didn't weight it heavily enough toward renewables. As a result, the projects that they actually ended up funding were too heavily reliant on diesel and natural gas, and they didn't want that. The two red arrows you see on the left there mark out the only two projects in round one that had any energy storage whatsoever. The red circled projects are the ones that are relying on natural gas and diesel. So in round two, they're not going to fund any projects that include more than 25% diesel generation. They're also requiring that renewables be paired with energy storage in round two to be counted toward generation capacity for these microgrids projects. I'm not going to go through again all of these, but it would be helpful to look at lessons learned from some of the northeastern states when you're thinking about this. I realize that you may not be looking at a Sandy type situation. You may be looking at an earthquake situation, perhaps. Nevertheless, I hope not, but nevertheless, some of these lessons learned will apply. I also want to talk a little bit about New Jersey. New Jersey is taking a somewhat different approach. They are funding a four-year program, $10 million for energy storage paired with renewables at critical facilities. These are not microgrids as we think of them. They are individual facilities, and these are smaller projects. They have taken the bold step of saying that they will not fund energy storage that is charged by grid power or dirty on-site generators. That is going to limit, in my opinion, severely the value streams that can be realized by these projects. These are choices that are being made by states, and every state is different. You need to make the right choice for your state. If you know, and this is just one example. If you limit energy storage in this way, then you're essentially saying you can't engage in energy arbitrage. You can't charge your resource at night when the rates are low, for example, off of the grid. That's going to impose some limitations on what kind of projects you can get. Nevertheless, that's the route New Jersey is taking, and they would like to use this program to build a market so that they don't have to continue to do this. As Emery mentioned earlier, you know, the idea here is to get these things, markets moving, so that the state doesn't have to continue to throw money at the problem. And finally, I want to mention Vermont. Initially, I had not thought that I could give any details on this because it hasn't been officially announced, but since Emery spilled the beans earlier, I can say that this is going to be an excellent project. It is going to provide both integration of renewables and a resilient power benefit. It is being done by a utility that has so much PV coming on to some of their circuits that they need some way to balance it. And this is Vermont. This is not Arizona. I was very surprised that there's that much PV, but there is. And with only a $50,000 state grant, they are getting $250,000 from DOE and several million from a utility that needs energy storage to solve a real problem. You need to identify the real problem, and you need to identify your partners that will have the resources to solve that problem. I need to end here, but we can talk more later. Thank you very much.
really glad that you could come today, because I know we have some folks in the room that their specialty is in emergency management, and they're looking for connections to energy storage. So they're coming from that side of things, wondering what applications may be good for them. And so it's really great to start to make those connections. I want to open it up for Q&A. We don't have a ton of time because we do need to talk about roundtables, and I need to let you eat so that you'll come back and participate in our roundtables. But let's get started. Who has questions? Go here, and go this gentleman, and then to Bill.
Yeah, a question for Praveen. On the Laurel Mountain project, and I presume the Ohio one as well, you're receiving this four-second signal from the ISO, I presume, and providing a service and getting paid in a market scheme. How many other places in the country is that basic business model available to you? Someone that can give you that signal, pay you under a market approach?
Well, that is this on? There it is. Okay. Well, that opportunity is available in all of the FERC jurisdictional markets where FERC's Order 890, which is a few years ago now, opened up the ancillary services markets in the FERC jurisdictional ISOs and RTOs to non-generator resources to compete on a comparable basis as generation. And that's just where the market rules are turned on to the point where, you know, if you're willing to take the risk on the installation cost and the market revenues, you can plug in and start earning. I think the rest of the country is also in play. It would just be under a different commercial structure, but the same purpose can be done. But in areas that are more integrated, I think they're actually in a better position to take advantage of this. But you know, you just need to have the entity who might be the balancing authority, who's also a load serving entity, transmission owner, or transmission operator, to come up with a case to provide that value either through something they own or a contract.
That work?
We'll have to let you guys talk after.
Yeah, in all the FERC jurisdictional markets, there's an hourly price for frequency regulation, spinning reserve, other services, but it changes every hour, so it's subject to risk.
That's great.
Todd, Vermont, I'm over here. Vermont has a problem. Too much PV, and evidently the local utility, that's hurting their balance sheet, right? So they're willing to park a couple of million dollars in battery projects. And they're doing that, I assume, because they expect a return on that $2 or $3 million. Could you describe that business situation a little bit?
Todd, and before you do, could you introduce yourself, please?
Yeah, my name is Rich Locke, Richard Locke. I work for the Washington State Department of Commerce.
Great, thank you.
Thank you.
Right. Well, I don't represent the utility, but they essentially, you know, as you know, many states, 30 states, including D.C., have renewable portfolio standards.
Right.
And so we have increasing goals and requirements to, you know, increase the amount of renewables on grids. And so what's happening is that the utilities, and it's not just in Vermont, are seeing increases in the intermittent renewables. There was a decision made that in Rutland, Vermont, they wanted to make it sort of a PV capital of the state or some such thing. They, as they described it, and this is in Burlington as well, you know, they're getting applications for PV constantly on, you know, a daily basis. So what they found is that they need that resource, and they're going, and it's not, I want to emphasize this. Utilities aren't doing this just, you know, for fun. I mean, they're doing it because they see that it's going to A, solve a problem, and B, provide some value stream to them. As an example, I talked to Burlington Electric, which is a municipal utility, and they're looking at energy storage because they're purchasing some of their power from a larger utility and during some part of the day, and they can decrease. Rates are based on things like demand charges, and they can significantly save money if they can shift some of their demand. Right, exactly. So they have very complex calculations. It's, as I said, you know, it's not every state's different. Every town and city are different, and every utility is different. So they're going to need to. They will adopt the technology if it's going to meet their need and solve a problem. And sometimes they just need a little help.
Great. Thank you. I think is the gentleman in the back. Oh, if you could wait for the microphone, because then we'll make sure to capture your question. Thank you.
This is John Kreider from the Oregon PUC. I got a question for Mel. Yeah, in your mandate, you talk about cost effectiveness quite mm-hmm. a lot. And I was wondering if the PUC is going to open a rulemaking to determine what the cost effectiveness parameters are, or are you going to leave that to the utilities to essentially state their case about cost effectiveness?
That's a really good question. So, in terms of a future rulemaking, I can't speak to that at this moment in time. Mm-hmm. I can say it's very likely we will open a future rulemaking at some time in the future, and it's very likely cost effectiveness will be examined in addition to other issues. In terms of what we're doing now, the mandate basically orders the utility to develop their own cost effectiveness protocols specific to their systems. In addition to that, they are also ordered to work with our staff and the other utilities in developing a common cost effectiveness benchmark, which uses some of the assumptions that were included in the EPRI and KEMA studies. And so that benchmark is just to have some level of uniformity in terms of assessing these various bids. So that's what's happening now, but that doesn't mean that we won't have additional cost effectiveness determinations later. So,
great. Question? Computing microphones.
So, Conrad Eustace, Portland General Electric. This is again a question for Mel. Storage, fundamentally like the gasoline in your tank, is a unit of energy.
Mm-hmm.
And so my big mystery is, why did California
ask.
specify it in gigawatts when you have the solar problem that's in gigawatt hours?
Yeah, we get that a lot. I was expecting that question. Basically, I think it had to do with the fact that the uses for storage are so varied and diverse, and we don't know what uses will be there. We didn't want to do gigawatt hours, so we made it a capacity mandate, and I think it's in line with our solar mandates and other renewable mandates that are capacity, but that's our sort of simple answer.
Great. We do need to move on, but good news, these people are around, except for Ken. I think that folks are around for questions. If you've been enjoying this panel, you might think about joining a roundtable related to value streams, prioritizing applications, support and tools. So this should really be triggering some good ideas for you in terms of developing recommendations. So I'll let Ruchi close us out and describe a little bit more about what you can expect from roundtables. But thank you, panel, for your time.
Thanks, Rebecca, and thanks to the panel. Just because you indicated an interest in a topic during online registration does not mean you were signed up for a roundtable. That might be a rumor. It is not true. Your last chance to sign up for roundtables is now at the table outside, manned by our helpful law students. Please help us by signing up for a roundtable. We're flipping this room while you're at lunch and need to know how many chairs to include at each table so you're not awkwardly standing on the side. We'd like to discourage rotating among roundtables. Please pick one and stay for the whole time, listen, and contribute to the conversation from beginning to end to shape recommendations that are developed and so they can be shared with the broader group later at the end of the day. The law students will be taking notes at each roundtable, but please speak freely and openly because comments will remain unattributed. We want to encourage frank discussion this afternoon. Roundtables will start at 1:30. Please enjoy lunch, but return on time. Seamless integration, which is the red star, if you have already signed up, the red star on your badge, and energy storage values, which is a silver star on your badge. Those roundtables will be held in the two classrooms that are around the corner this way. So if you come back in, you'll go around this room and you'll see two classrooms there. The remaining four roundtables will meet in this room after we, of course, flip it. There are some lunch suggestions, I believe, outside for you if you're not familiar with the area. So please enjoy lunch and see you in an hour. Thank you.
Thank you.
It's interesting to hear what you guys are doing.
Yeah, it's an interesting time. You know, I was advisor to John Mellencroft, whose term ended in November, so I've been working on more Western issues, and so it's kind of unclear. The future agenda of the commission is decided very much by the chairman, and that's in state of flux. So
okay.
It's interesting.